Okay, so should be able to see if you scroll it through the chat the previous dates of the 3rd of December as we roll around to the 3rd of February. With the defense against the weapons of Minerva, the world of Aeon Gaia entered into a long span of peace. The outsiders stopped their incursions, and would-be evildoers were put in their place with the installment of 4 more Heroes of Light. 2 months full of rebuilding, diplomacy talks, and making the world an easier place to live after the hardships of the past year. While evil is at bay, a few forces that lay dormant arise to challenge the new heroes, but are quickly doused before their flames of war move any further than their doorsteps. Necromancers building armies, ice giants in the North Caps, warring monster tribes. All are easy issues for those who have reached the pinnacle of mundane power and progress into divine might. But while the material plane is entering a term of peace, aside from the minuscule menaces in comparison to the heroes, the other planes are not so lucky to have beings such as those to protect them. After their 2 months of rest from the weapon debacle, the party are gathered together once more for yet another threat that only they can deal with, lest the planes destabilize for the last time. Though during these 2 months of helping the continents, taking orders from either the deity Minerva, which they are patron to, resting in their own homes or places of work, some of you having several homes to call, you have been saving the material plane from lesser threats. And through that time, we shall investigate what each of you have been doing. Starting off, in the frozen north of Shiva Hollow. A rising force brought forth by the Ice Queen Zetra. Both elementals and bombs have been summoned out from the nearby plains. Not exactly an incursion, so to speak, rather someone using their own magics to do so. It is quite uncommon for a mage to be able to summon so many creatures at once, the Ice Queen possibly having some sort of relic or maybe some knowledge passed down to her by a deity that has allowed her to do such. It is also possible she has come unto the power of being able to use calling magic, at which point the outsiders aren't exactly summoned, they're instead allowed entry through a door into this plane. Though doing so is a dangerous task for the outsiders, as if they were to die in such a case, they do not return to their plane. Aside from the chilly outsiders that have been coming over into the ice caps, she has also been creating several golems, showing off a vast knowledge of both a summoning art and that of a creation. Osa was tasked by her continent to deal with the disturbances in Shiva Hollow. As the continent itself is normally fine to deal with such harshness, Ivan Braos is quite on the opposite side, as if these creatures were to move just a bit northwards, crossing over the oceans that wouldn't cause them as much issues, the desert lands could have quite a war in their hands. Moving to the Shiva Hollow ice caps, Osa has been decimating and cutting through all of the creations he has found thus far. And with her minuscule knowledge over such things, she has come to find a lot of their weaknesses through brawn and muscle. Taking down the elementals, the bombs, and the golems, she eventually reached the tower of ice that Cetra had formed. As this was her base, plenty of the creatures had guarded it more harshly than the scout she had sent out. Oh, sir, give me 2 strength rolls, please.
Okay.
As Osa cuts her way through the enemies in her path, she's able to bash through several icy barriers, though almost as if it was made out of living ice, or the Ice Queen herself reforming them as she looks upon you from her tower. It proves to be a difficult task. Every time you smash through a wall, it reforms and heals. And it seems the chilly nature of the North doesn't really suit your fighting style too well, nor the clothing you wear. You don't have to worry too much about the cold itself harming you, though it has definitely slowed you. Each wall takes several slices from your axe or mighty fists. You eventually make your way through the tower, though it takes a longer time than you had hoped or planned for. Eventually reaching the top, you're able to slice down the lieutenant, or whatever you could have called them, of the Ice Queen. Her throne room, a icy display of power. In her hand, a staff as tall as her, peaked with a shining diamond. Sadly, with the lack of any more magically inclined party members, you could only guess at what it was, though you can roll a Knowledge Arcana or Spellcraft. You can do those untrained.
God, I have those, I guess. Is it either or?
Either or.
Doesn't make a difference. It's not too bad.
As you look upon the staff, you're unable to tell any of its more finer traits, though you're definitely sure it's not something you could have bought in a shop. The Ice Queen stands tall from her throne as she sends out several shards of ice towards you. And I need you to make me an acrobatics and a reflex save, please.
An acrobatics?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, nice.
Dodging and weaving around these shards of ice, you close the gap between you and the Ice Queen. However, the disastrous nature of her throne room and that it was being made of ice allows the Queen to shape and shift it as she pleases, making chasms, tall pillars, and even jagged rocks. It slows you down enough that the Ice Queen is able to send off more and more blasts against you, cooling your frame and coating your axe in ice, though your very certain that it won't damage it too much, it'll just soften the blow against someone who is more inclined to the element. Making your way almost face to face with the Queen, you are bloodied and scarred, though you slowly heal over your wounds, and to the fact that your rage allows you to go for minutes on end, you've been able to reach her in less than a day, though it has been a painful trek. In front of you, she is almost defenseless as you are opened up to an attack. It was up to you how you wish to deal with the Ice Queen.
Good question. Well, she's a human. Or Elvan, or something.
She is Elvan.
I would probably try to take her in non-lethally.
Alright, how would you like to do so? Are you going to bonk her over the head, or...?
Just bonk her in the head. Using, like, force, but try not to make it lethal.
Yeah. Alright. Bringing down your axe flat side down onto the Ice Queen's head. It makes a resounding clang noise that echoes throughout the icy chamber. A massive bruise forms on her forehead as you see her body start to shake and quiver. The staff from her hands falls to the floor as the wood also echoes out. Falling into her throne, the Ice Queen has been knocked unconscious. Though with her control over the nearby area being wrested from her, you feel the ice beneath your feet start to shake, as dust from above starts to fall down, the ice cracking all around you. What do you wish to do?
Pick her up and shield her as much as I can while trying to get down without getting buried.
Are you leaving the staff behind?
Was it knocked down, like, right next to her or something?
Yeah, it's on the floor.
Yeah, I'll pick it up as well.
Alright, lifting up the Ice Queen and having the staff in the other hand, you make a dart for the exit. Large chunks of ice fall from the ceiling as the walls crack and fall around you. Give me a acrobatics, please. It is a hard escape, especially without the magical enchantments that your allies would have given you, as well as your armor weighing you down and that of the unconscious mark on your shoulder. Jumping from mound to mound, you are cascaded with stabs and blunt strikes from the ice around you. Though again, it may cause pain, but you are able to get your way through it. Darting towards the exit, you can see the tall spiral staircase collapsing beneath you as the tower starts to lean and fall backwards. Jumping through one of the opened up windows, you make your way onto the side of the tower. As it continues to fall backwards, you slide down its edge. I need you to give me either an acrobatics or a climb check of your choice.
Climb.
Placing the staff in your maw, you use your free claw to grab onto the side of the tower. Scraping across it with your claws, you're able to slow the fall, as even though you may have survived what the fall would have been, there was a possibility you could drop the woman you were carrying. The shards of ice continue to slice off of the sides, as well as a mist forming behind you, and you eventually slide down to the base. In just enough time, the tower falls behind you, crashing into the ice caps and causing a large crack to form across the glaciers. They get closer and closer towards you as you have to make a mad dash away from them. And I need you to give me another acrobatics, please. You dart your way away from the approaching doom, as even though you're semi-immortal in your rage state and have plenty of health to spare, being frozen underneath the waters would definitely be an eternal prison until someone would find you. At which point, you know that you're not being able to get away from the cracks and falling beneath. You have to make a choice of either keeping the staff or keeping the Ice Queen.
I'll keep the Ice Queen.
Moving the Ice Queen into position that allows you to charge faster, you drop the staff beneath you. It falls into one of the other cracks that forms up and falls into the waters below. You can hear ice forming even below, as if the ice staff changes any form of water it comes into contact with into more ice. And with your new form, you're able to dash away from the cracks and get to a safe distance by the time a large portion of the ice cap breaks off and starts to slowly flow away. With the Ice Queen in captivity, you take it to one of the major cities of Shiva Hollow. They're able to place caster cuffs upon her, as well as drain her of her mana in case she's able to get across such. She's taken to whatever fraud he would deal with her, and you're praised and rewarded for your duties. As you are recovering, sitting down upon a bench, as well as people giving you praise in the distance, along with the call of your name and that of your fan clubs quickly rising across the world, a link is formed with your mind as Minerva calls you back to her domain. And with Osa finishing her duties with the Ice Queen and responding to Minerva, we'll move to the next in the list. Far into the jungles and forest and plains of the Triconfection Isles, Joseph has been tasked with not as much of a difficult task in the way of fighting, though it could have been if he wished to. Instead, he is tasked with uniting the more goblinoid tribes set across the isles. As the beaches are set up as vacation spots, and the islands themselves being places for people to retire to, an uprising of goblins definitely makes the place a much less hospitable area. Joseph, give me either a diplomacy or a knowledge local.
Ooh, I think knowledge local is going to be higher. Let me double check.
It's higher. I rolled a one. All right.
That's still almost higher than I can get with the other one, though.
Yeah, it's fine. This is a very high bonus. After being requested to sort out these issues with the tribes, you spend some time amongst the goblins themselves, as well as with their neighbors. Talking with the populace, you were able to deduce that there were four different forms of tribes. There's the Greenskins and the Brownskins, and then the separate factions of the Hobgoblins and the Halfbreeds. So much information is given to you that you even have to make up a sort of diary or book to keep all the details in. You spend quite a few days moving about the tribes and the neighboring areas, getting as much information as you can. As you can find that the original currents of these tribes having issues with one another is their thievery nature. The Green and Browns, obviously forming up together as they are so close in relation, had stolen several items, though they call them artifacts and relics, you're pretty sure they aren't, from the Hobgoblin tribes. And in doing so, they were able to also use their dirty silvery tongues to make it seem like the half-breeds were the one who did the theft. As it comes up to your decision on how to sort one of these issues, a few decisions come to mind. You could save the effort of doing any more investigation and just outright kill all the goblins, or three of the tribes that only one is still living. It'd be very easy for you to do with your stealth capabilities, as well as being able to use the shadows to make it seem like they never even knew you were coming. Or you could steal said relics and return them to their rightful owners and play it off as if they were just misplaced and that word of mouth got too out of hand. Or you can take all of their items and called to a meeting, forming the four tribes into a sort of council, and dividing the relics evenly amongst them. What decision would you like to go with?
I would like to attempt the third decision. And if it doesn't go as planned, I will reveal the truth of the clan that stole from the other clan and then blamed it on the other one, and then have those two gang up against the one that was stealing and spreading lies.
All right. Roll me a disguise. And then roll me either a knowledge local or a diplomacy. Okay. With your abilities, you're able to ingratiate yourself within the different goblin tribes, talking with them and possibly getting some... Can you speak goblinoid?
Yes, I can.
Or goblin? Alright, so you don't need any sort of translations. That's fine. Moving through them as one of their own, you're able to discuss with all of the different goblins. And it seemed like there are 6 relics in total. An annoying number, as there are 4 tribes. And you're able to find out their locations, as well as the actual goblins in particular that stole them. However, if you are to steal them for yourself, it will require you to make a stealth and a sleight of hand check.
So I need to do that in order to get that third one done?
Yes. As you move through both the day and the night, since a lot of these goblins just sleep through the entire day sometimes, you're able to go into their treasure holds and their homes, though you definitely wouldn't call it one if you compare it to your homes, and you're able to gather up the 6 relics. And looking upon them with your own eyes, they definitely should not be called relics or anything near that. You're pretty sure half of them aren't even magical, but it's possible they hold some sort of sentimental value or something to do with their own religions. With the 6 relics in hand, you're able to see that the goblins get more and more frustrated, shouting out that their relics had been stolen, or having their own stolen goods being stolen a second time. At which point, the goblins are rearing up for a fight, though it is down to you to be able to calm their emotions. You can either roll a diplomacy or a bluff. Okay, and do you have anything in particular you want to spin that these items weren't stolen in the first place or what? Or do you just wish to have your character do it?
I will insinuate that somebody else had stolen all of these items, like a group of people had stolen all these items. I have gathered those said stolen items and brought them here in order to bring the tribes together and help them protect all of their relics together as a single unified group, because they're stronger together than they could be separate.
They are going to ask who stole them, but you can roll intimidate to make it so that nobody wants to ask you that question ever again. Or you can try and make something up.
I will glare at them and say dead bodies, and I guess I will try intimidate.
Yeah.
Not bad.
Very intimidating.
As you look across the goblinoids, some of them who saw you as kin during your infiltration time, a lot of them kind of like even take a step back or drop their weapons as they fumble around trying to stay tall against you. Though a lot of these guys only come up to your stomach. A few of them come up to your head height, but they're more the guys who are the low-ranking soldiers. They all seem like they don't really want to ask or push any further, and they accept that you had indeed killed the thieves who took the relics. And as you bring up the 4 tribes into a form of council, you find that a lot of these leaders, as you could call them, are more dim-witted than you could have hoped for, though it does mean you have to teach them the meaning of some words and some laws. At which point, you can either roll intelligence or linguistics. It's a good thing you know goblinoids, as you don't mess up the translations. You're able to breach the concepts of camaraderie and group working, as well as some other concepts that they had never even thought about. To the point that you're pretty sure one of these may become an engineer one day, but now's not that day. They all come around to the ideas that working together would be the best course of action. However, there's still some bad blood between them, and they wish to know what's going to be done with the 6 relics, as there is 4 tribes. How would you like to go about dealing with this situation?
Is it possible to try to unify them into one single tribe, get them all to work together in one area and protect their relics by just being a bigger group?
That is going to be taking a diplomacy role if you do that.
Ooh, much lower.
You breach the topic of them kind of disbanding their four separate tribes and forming a big tribe. And even though they understand the concepts of working together, they aren't ready to be laying in the same beds as four different species, essentially. A lot of them just decline the notion of forming into one.
All right, are they equally distributed? Are there separate tribes? Like, is it like a box that is their territories? Or is it more
than that? They do have separate territories. It's not boxes. It's like weird squiggly lines they have on their maps. But a lot of them have different maps and different squiggly lines. So it is kind of contested a lot. But they do have specific areas they can go to.
Is there like a centralized area where all four corners kind of touch in one space?
You can see it more like it's a circle, just a squiggly circle, and then there is an epicenter with all the four different lines meet.
Okay, I will declare that this little area, like within a quarter mile, is a safe zone. It is a holy zone, and they are not to fight or bicker or steal from each other when they're within this area. They are only to cooperate and communicate, and this is the area that the four relics are going to stay. They will stay all together, like just like they are going to build a building, and they will have these relics stay here, and they will belong to all of the tribes. And they will ration out who gets what at any given time based on need.
All right, roll me either diplomacy or an intimidate. As you bring up the idea of having a centralized temple as such, as some of these do view the relics as religious, they come to accept it, as a few of the people that you have taught these concepts to seem to have been enlightened, and that they take your word without any drawbacks. At which point, you can roll sense motive, though I'm pretty sure you'll just auto-pass. So let's see. Yeah, you would auto-pass. They all agree to the centralized area where they'll set up these six relics and divvy out items when it best suits them. However, just knowing the goblins and how long you spent with them, you are sure this won't be a forever thing. It's possible they would destabilize within a few months, but that's a few months that you don't have to deal with them. At which point the neighboring settlements can have some peace and quiet, or set up their own plans of dealing with the goblins when the times come. You can also set yourself a late date to come back and reinstate these orders to them. But for now, you have dealt with them. And returning to one of the Triconfection capitals, you're able to debrief with the leaders. They aren't ecstatic about the outcome, though they do accept that this is a good path nonetheless. They give you your awards, as you're given yet another speck of time to yourself. And as you dine on the luxuries of the Triconfection Isles from both their feasts and their alcohol, you are also telepathically contacted by Minerva to go meet her. And as Joseph's ordeal with the goblins is done, we move to a place much further away. With his deep knowledge of the arcane, both from his studies and even witnessing it through the towers, Iskandor was requested by Minerva to go investigate the magical disturbances across the material plane. And whilst he has never been here, the magic on display definitely feels familiar to the Archmage. With the ability of detect magic and true seeing, he is able to eventually come across a wasteland of corpses. At which point, Iskandor, you can make a Knowledge Arcana check. From looking across the wasteland, the corpses all seem to be rather old. Some of them old enough that their skeletons shouldn't be here. However, you see a prevailing aura of teleportation magic all around. These bodies were taken here, either immediately after their death or sometime after it. All of the corpses were of powerful beings, all the way up to dragons. You even find the skeletal head of an ancient dragon towards the epicenter of the graveyard. And from teleporting the corpses here, you would have assumed that with all of these skeletons, they would have been raised as an undead army, as they would have been some of the better undead to use just from their size and their strength, as undead typically lose their spells and special abilities. However, as you scour the wastelands, you're unable to see any form of raising undead's magic. But you do see a prevailing sense of dark shadow and evil, as if a force was drawing these here for some reason. As you look around, you can roll a spellcraft. Looking around, you can see the misty and wispy auras of portals, some of the most recent transportations to this area. And as you look upon them, you can see that the portals are both teleportations that would be done across the material plane, as well as that of extraplanar travel. The corpses were brought here, and it seems they were being shipped to a different plane. You're unsure where it leads to, as they are very faint at this point, though it has happened several times. You can't tell which of the corpses were taken, as they have no presence of what they used to be, though you're surprised that the dragons were left here when others were taken away. And you can then make a perception roll. Moving across the wasteland, trying to put the pieces together, you find more and more disturbing sights. Aside from the skeletons, you're able to find some flesh inside the massive skull of the dragon. Towards its back portion, you find a mass of brain matter, almost as if someone was taking the brains out of the corpses and messing with them. At which point, with the aid of true seeing, detect magic, and other detection abilities, you can make a... it'll be a heal check or a knowledge nature.
Just checking which one's better. I think it's going to be heal. Yeah.
As you look over the brain matter, you probably dealt with some of this before from your cybernetic enhancements. You can see that the brains all have, well, they're all in a jumble, so it's hard to see if each brain had one. But you see several very tiny specks of brain matter that have a divine aura around them, almost as if they were tampered with by an incredibly powerful relic or artifact, or possibly from a deity themselves. There's also the theory that these could have been affected by a hero of light or a villain of darkness, though it's hard to tell from where they would come from. Seeing these powers at play, you do have a decision to make with what you wish to do with the brain matter. You're unsure if it's just left here as just a leftover, or if there being a way to be transported. So it's up to you if you wish to dispel whatever magics are here, or you can take them for yourself and do your own experiments.
I'll take them for my own experiments.
Alright, roll me Knowledge Arcana again, please. You're able to section out the brain matter into different clumps, though it's incredibly hard to tell what belongs to what. You're pretty sure some clumps belong to 5 different individuals, whereas others could be up to 10. As you section these out, you put them into either boxes or bags at your disposal, and you save them for later. As you take the brain matter away, you can hear, as well as feel, a scratching in the back of your head, almost as if something is just putting their finger through your ear and scratching the back of your brain. At which point, you need to give me a will save, please.
It starts already, I say. this is 2 lower, because I can't take out the one from the class.
Okay.
And I have no buffs on, so it's not great.
As you feel the scratching, you instinctively move your hand to just scratch your ear and the back of your head. As you do so, you can feel a long, spindly finger. It has sinews of flesh still on it, though it's almost is towards the bone. As you turn your head around, you don't spot anything. And in your hand, there's something there, not even any sort of moistness from a piece of flesh. You feel as if somebody's watching you or altering you, but without seeing it, it's hard to make it certain. You're also unsure if your previous paranoia is creeping back up on you.
But you said
how would you like fixed? Well, I said it was fixed. I didn't say for how long. It's also your character. Your character doesn't know I exist.
True.
At this event, what would you like to do?
I'd like to... Do I still feel like I'm being tampered with?
Not currently, no, but there is that just kind of like faint sense that it's still there.
I would like to cast an anti-magic field on myself.
Alright. As you summon up a anti-magic field, the field surrounds you as you feel your items disable, though your speck of divinity is still there, as you know that divine powers can't exactly just be taken away as like that. And as you do so, your detect magic intrusing will also disappear, at which point you only see the mundane and nothing else happens.
At which point I will drop the field and see if I can detect anything else, because I was just wondering if it was still going to mess with me during when the field was on, because that would imply it's particularly powerful.
Ending the anti-magic field, all of your effects come back to you, though nothing really seems to continue messing with your head. Leaving the skull of the dragon, it seems that you chose the opportune moment to leave, as when its maw was open, it slammed shut behind you, the bone cracking and making a loud noise that echoes throughout the area. You're unsure as if something had altered it, or it had finally given up and decided to close. But you know, you're not trapped, and you're not exactly harmed. You just feel the rush of air as the jaw closes behind you. As it does so, you hear a murder of crows up ahead start to crawl as they all fly away from the area. And looking back to the skull, towards the top of it, you could swear you could have seen an image of a humanoid man, but as soon as you blink your eyes, they are gone. Instead, in their place, you see another portal of teleportation magic.
Is it dissipating, or could I potentially
It's dissipating.
Oh, okay. Maybe the other one's moving then. This is bad news. Do I have any way of trying to actually complete my objective as to why they're here? Like these bodies?
You were sent here to investigate, not exactly sort it out.
Oh, right, okay. I haven't found much. Apart from creepy finger ear people. Can I roll planes to see if there's any kind of, well, anything about this place which where it could be connected to these portals?
That you can. You can roll those planes.
Skill unlock, sorry, it's a lot of text.
It's fine. As you look around the area, investigate the portals and what avenues are open to you, again, it's hard to tell which planes the portals are going to, as you're going to see the ending portion of them. However, you're pretty sure they're not going to any of the elemental planes. It's possible they are going to the ethereal plane, as your true seeing are showing you a few visions here or there of those in the ethereal plane. But aside from that, you can't tell much else. You do know that this area is kind of vast, but it's not an uncontrollable area. If you were to spend the time, you could set up enough anchoring spells to stop this place being able to be teleported in or out of through the planes.
I almost feel like it'd be better to set up a trap to see what's coming back here, but yeah, I don't have any way of doing that, so I'll have to spend the time.
Spending about 2 days here, you set up circle after circle of anchoring spells that make it so that planar travel is almost impossible to do. You wouldn't stop a deity themselves, though it definitely gives some issue to a villain of darkness if there are any interfering here. Or if there are just mundane creatures doing this, they'll have especially no chance to get through unless they dispel your magics, at which point it would take them almost as long to do so. Finishing at the wasteland, you make a good map of the area as well as notes that you would hand off to Minerva to have her deal with it later. However, you also do notify the nearby settlements of the area, at which point they make sure that they'll set up some watchtowers closer to it, though they will say that this place is cursed. Though you won't say it isn't, because you have seen images yourself, and it is possible that mundane creatures could have sight into the ethereal plane here or there. The place will be looked after, and you have been assured that if they do notice anything, they'll try and contact you or someone else who can contact you. They give you a pearl so that they can talk to you through ascending. Though if you yourself were to go to a different plane, they wouldn't be able to contact you.
I see.
With your job here done, or at least to the best of your ability, as you were asked to come here by Minerva, you return back to her sanctum. As we go to the final member, or at least the new member. During this time of the 2 months, you'll all know that Leonard had his own mission to undertake, as he was originally set under Iskandor by the Nifel army to protect him. It came to a point where Iskandor didn't need his protection, as well as Leonard's emplacement running out. With his powers as a hero, he decided it would be best to traverse the lands helping those in need, rather than just being held accountable to the capitals and the deity. You'll eventually come to pass where Leonard was given a task from Minerva, at which point you haven't heard from him since, though since you can always detect the other heroes of light, you know that Leonard is still alive, he is just busy. And we go to a new face and a new land working for a new deity. high amongst a floating platform within the continent of Bahamut's head. A not-so-young soldier who has been working her way across the continents meets up with the gargantuan force that is the deity Bahamut. Through trials, tribulations, and doing hero duty without the title, Yuki Tempest has made her way to the domain, or at least one domain, of Bahamut. Through talking with him, as well as researching, she knows that the deity doesn't exactly spend a lot of time on the material plane, and thus this could be seen as a higher temple to the deity that he would frequent. Instead of going after the elemental crystals, Yuki is the other type of Hero of Light, being chosen for her deeds alone. And as Bahamut's Heroes of Light have dwindled over time, and being kind of the de facto leader of the Pantheon, it's possible he has some higher authority to have more than just one, or even zero. With Rama having Axel Phoenix and Minerva having four of her own, it wouldn't be right for Bahamut to be left without any. Yuki was granted the position of Hero of Light, and instead of being given an element of crystal, she has a small obsidian sphere, like a marble ball, in her pocket that she uses to converse and teleport to this place where Bahamut would be. Yuki has been given her own tasks from the deity, as well as nearby settlements, though Yuki has yet to be fully put into the famous limelight, keeping her duties hidden. There will be times she goes to a settlement and helps them out. The villagers can't help but wonder what power Yuki holds, that she is able to deal with their issues. And it comes to a day, just like any other, where Bahamut calls upon the work of Yuki. Standing tall upon his mountaintop, he speaks to her.
Yuki Tempest, my Hero of Light, I call upon you, as I have done so many times before. Another task I must give on to you. Are you prepared to leave for some time? I know you have plenty of knowledgeable people on this plane that would like to use your services.
Yuki will fall down to her knee, bowing, and say, "Of course, my liege. I'll follow anything that you require."
Good. You have not worked for me long, but in the time you have proven useful and loyal. However, this task is quite different from the others. Instead of working for me or the settlements of this realm, you will instead be working for another, one of my creation. Have you heard, or at least read, about the deity Minerva?
Yes, my lord. The name rings a bell, and I have read very much into the other deities. What would you have me do?
Good. That makes this conversation all the more quicker. Minerva has a task of her own coming up. And as we are kin, I seek to aid her. One of her own Heroes of Light, you may have heard them on the winds, has been taken up with another task, though a mission coming up to her is needing four. For the duration of such a task, I ask that you go to my kin and aid them. A singular mission, though it may take some time. And be forewarned, you have traversed this material plane for some time, but her task shall be extra planar.
Okay, I understand. So just help out her other heroes. Shouldn't be too bad. I'm sure I can handle it.
Aid them as best you can. Though as any task that you have undertaken, there shall be no confirmation on your return. Your contract is the same as theirs. You may discuss it with them as you please. Though remember, going against Minerva shall be going against me. So hold your tongue and mind your actions.
Of course, my lord. I would never try and soil your name. I'll do my best to uphold you as I always do.
Good. Then I shall send you to her domain. This shall not be a common occurrence. It shall only be this one time, until later. Hold yourself tight, as this shall be a different form of movement than you are used to.
Yuki stands and prepares herself.
Waving his hands over Yuki, she is enveloped in a silvery dark light as her body morphs and shifts into a pure beam of light. She shoots into the air and then straight down into the ground as she tunnels towards Minerva's domain.
Were the other three of us warned about this other person showing up out of nowhere in our domain?
Not yet, no.
Oh.
Just as they have done so several times before, Iskandora, Joseph, and Osa hold their elemental crystals that they had gathered through the Crystal Tower trials. The heroes turn into beams of light as usual and shoot into the sky. A common occurrence that people have likened to falling stars. Bystanders stare at the dazzling lights that move through the sky, making wishes on the heroes as they move through the world, either to personally aid them or to help the world at large. The heroes never hear these prayers, but through their deeds, and at least a few, are answered. With a burst of magical might, the party emerges one by one in a blast of wind, their feet landing on the marble flooring that echoes ever so slightly. The domain of Minerva has continued to stay the same, a constant in the world that is ever changing. As if the black glass of the Shadow Plane never existed, this place is pristine in cleanliness and holiness. At which point you can see that there are three others, one of them being a new face in the form of Yuki, and Yuki seeing the three heroes of light she had heard so much of before. Before you're able to converse, however, a burst of yellow, white, and blue lights appears as Minerva shows herself to the party, hovering over the floor. Holding a look of slight worry, Minerva addresses the party. Welcome, my heroes of light. I have summoned you all here for your next combined task, one that requires the force of four heroes rather than a singular entity. You will see amongst your group a new face and one lacking of Leonard. The man is currently absorbed in another task I've set forth for him, and thus I contacted the deity Bahamut, my elder, to send me an aid. This has come in the form of Yuki Tempest. Treat her as you would another party member. At which Yuki, point you can react.
Yeah, Yuki will bow and say, "It's a pleasure to meet you, Heroes of Light of Minerva. And to you, my lady, it's a pleasure to meet you."
What's Joseph's sense motive for?
Joseph is just automatically against any person he's never met before. He's immediately suspicious and he wants to find out their true motives.
What is Yuki's true motives?
To uphold Bahamut's word, make sure his lower name is taken over anything else, and to do the best she possibly can.
Joseph, you think she's a bit too holy, but doesn't seem like a threat to you.
All right.
Lady Minerva, it will be a pleasure. It's been quite some time since I've seen Joseph and Osa, and Yuki will be a welcome addition, I'm sure. What exactly is this task if it requires all four of us?
Welcome to Backup Plan, I guess. I'm Joseph, this is Osa, and that's Escondor over there.
It's a pleasure to meet you all. As I'm sure you've heard, my name is Yuki. An interesting name that your team has.
It's a long story.
Well, and I'd love to hear over food some point.
I'm sure we can go over that when we understand what we're here for, Yuki. I take it the fact that you're here speaks for your competency. You'll be a welcome addition.
Well, thank you for your kind words. I hope to live up to them.
Lady Minerva, what task requires all four of us? As much as I enjoy seeing Joseph and Osa, and of course meeting Yuki, is this overkill or is it a threat that needs a response of this magnitude?
You have had a modicum of time to rest from the sinful event 2 months prior, but now your power is needed once again. I require you all to traverse from this plane to another, and perhaps another after that. In all truth, I am unsure of how long you will be gone, but trust me that this request is of the utmost importance. You may remember the planar incursion of demons and devils not too long ago, from both Deraganar and the Valkyros Heights core. Aside from that, the knowledge of primal infusion leaped, or was taught, to your fellows. Both of these occurrences have been patched up, but I fear a similar event is on its way. Forces are rising in our neighboring plains, and sadly for the denizens of such places, they lack heroes to save them. You will find their beings are stronger than the average material plane dweller, but you are far beyond that measuring stick at this point in time. I seek to follow the tethers of curiosity through the plains and see their origin, in the hopes we can stop whatever catastrophe would rear its head on your plane. Your speck of divinity will help you traverse through the planes, but it will not protect you fully. Many planes lack an atmosphere for you to relish in, but none of you requires air to breathe. Aside from the atmospheric changes, things such as gravity, physical laws, and the way magic functions will vastly change based on your location. I can only aid so much to the end of healing you for each trip, as well as opening portals for you to move between the planes. But that is the extent of my aid for this task. My sight and grasp is also limited within the other planes, as my domain is set within the core of Aeon Gaia. If you are to fall, you will fall as normal. Do you have any questions about the specifics of this mission?
Does anyone else want to go first?
I think I'm okay.
Do we typically know what planes you will be sending us to, or is it a variety?
Your first port of call will be the elemental plane of Holy. This has been the oldest location of said disturbance. A place that cannot hold shadow has shown signs of a dark power surviving in the mass of light. From the place you appear, I beseech you to search out the capital city of Maradorma. There you will find the elder monk Goxfalt, his humanoid name, of course. His holy name cannot be interpreted by material beings. As the oldest and wisest of the Severati, he should have some knowledge of where best to investigate this dark energy. The Severati monks are cautious beings, however. They will most likely test your character, but I warn you, do not go out of your way to end any of their lives. From where you'll go from the elemental plane of Holy, I do not know as of yet, but it will eventually be known to all of us.
I see. And does this have anything to do with the laughter we heard in the last issue we dealt with? Do you believe that the mastermind of the sins is the mastermind of this incursion?
I don't know if it has anything to do with that laughter you or the catalysts had heard. Though it is possible that the knowledge that was seeped out has been seeping through the planes, I warn you that you may have to face other primals, though that may not be the case depending on the knowledge that has seeped out.
I see. Gee, did you want to say something? Sorry.
No.
Ah, so I just saw your light up, that was all.
I was just typing.
Ah.
Making notes.
Sort of.
What was the town or city or whatever she wanted us to seek out? What was the name of it?
The name of the
capital.
You are going to the capital city of Maradorma.
Are there any, shall we say, rules of engagement while in the plane? As your envoys, we don't want to besmirch your reputation, as I'm sure that Yuki does not want to besmirch Bahamut's. Are there any things we cannot do, barring what you've already said so far?
Aside from knowing the languages of Enochian and Celestial, you may be able to converse with the beings in the common tongue, though their speech may be broken. Aside from what language you use, you are free to use both mine and Bahamut's name as you traverse the plains. They will eventually find out that you are heroes of light either way. You all give off a certain aura, and the holy beings there can see through to the depths of anyone's being. Though it does often take times to fight to make sure it is fully shown. Aside from that, stick to the contract as usual.
Of course, we may not mention this agreement with others. Is Iskander will point at Yuki. Is Yuki part of the contract we may speak to, or do we have to keep the specifics of our contract separate from hers, as she must keep it from ours?
You may discuss amongst yourselves the contracts. They are virtually the same amongst all deities, with only very minute changes. The only ones you're not allowed to speak with is non-heroes of light.
I see. In that case, I have no more questions thus far.
You can make a knowledge planes if anyone has it trained.
Nah, sorry guys.
Alright. Well, going in blind. Alright, Joseph got it. At least someone has it. Nah, it's gonna do all that's too much text, you don't know.
Damn.
Okay. Both Joseph and Iskandor know about the elemental plane of Holy. It is a generally more commonly known one. All of the elemental planes are not exactly common knowledge, but if you go to a school, this is like the first thing they'll tell you about. At which point, you can have this handout. The elemental plane of Holy is a place wholly made up of the holy magics as well as light. The most mechanical changes you would know is that gravity counts as two times than it does on the material plane, which essentially means that your anything you're carrying or wearing counts as two times its weight. And that link should work to bring to the page, though it is being slow. I don't know why it's being slow. Gravity. Alright, oh god, it worked, and then I broke it. It should have like a minus two, but PFSRD is being slow for some reason. When it loads. Oh, there we go. Alright, so, with the heavy gravity, you will take a minus two penalty to acrobatics, climb, ride, and swim. Most of those aren't really going to affect anyone here, but they also put a minus two penalty on any attack roll you make. As well as falling damage, but again, falling damage will come up when it comes up. It has an unbounded realm, which means that it basically is a sphere. You see, if you walk to one end, you basically just appear on the other end and keep going around the circle. Its essence is holy, which means it's more inclined to that, which is noted further down. It has limited magic, which I'll note further down. The most common denizens of the plane of holy are djinn, which is basically genies, holy elementals, and civil dragons, as well as the Severati. And the divinities that you would commonly see here would be Alexander, as he is the most holy and lawful good deity that there is. It doesn't mean he is going to be there, but there is a possibility he could be there. And the description for the holy plane is that it is a roaring space of multicolored lights that make up cities and plains. It is completely devoid of the color black, to which point it can blind natives who first go there. Aside from its general description, which would be a long time to get through, you know, just from her talking, as well as your knowledge, that the Severati are beings wholly composed of holy lights that resemble normal humanoids. They come in various hues of yellow and red, and parts of their body are solid, whereas others are basically just like the stage between water and air. This is also a heaven of sorts for followers of Alexander, as devout worshippers who die can come to this plane and live out their afterlife here. As when you go to there, you basically become a Severati, and you no longer need to eat, drink, breathe, sleep, and all the other things. You essentially have a life that doesn't have pain. You'll also know that Severati don't technically die. They disperse into lights and then are reborn into a new life. As such, they don't give birth, but they do have familial bonds with those that appear at the same time as them. And onto the magic part. Spells of the dark, elemental fire and wind, and necromancy spells cannot be cast on the plane. And any spells that deal with the undead also cannot be cast within the plane. I don't know where it says within this spell. It should be within this plane. I'll have to change that on my side. So that would deal with, if you go onto the spells list at the top left and say schools and whatnot, there'll be just those. And then since its essence is holy, shadows are not a concept on the plane. As such, there will be no such thing as darkness, dim light, or any sort of shadows. This mostly just comes up for Entro, who teleports through shadows. That would be impossible because they don't exist.
Aww.
And any shadow or darkness-related spells or effects do not function in the plane. So stuff like black light, darkness, and I think there's also a ninja spell that teleports through shadows that also can't work here.
Okay.
Objects and most creatures native to the plane are semi-physical beings made of pure light, which allows them to alter their form to become solid to interact with other solid matter. Creatures that are weak to holy damage, I don't think that applies to anyone here, take 1d6 points of holy damage per round until they can be destroyed. Or if a creature is made completely up of shadows, in the case of shadow elementals, I think Gespensts also count as that. If they're made of shadows, they take 1d10 instead. A foreign creature within the plane must exceed a DC 15 fortitude save, which I think everyone here does by default unless they fumble, or you will become blinded for a minute. Once you've existed on the plane for 10 minutes, you don't need to worry about that until you leave and come back.
I don't yet, unless I put buffs on.
Okay.
I won't auto-pass it, just for fairness. I don't.
I mean, you're going to roll either way, but...
Eh.
Creatures of lawful or good alignments receive fast healing 5 for as long as you stay on the plane and keep those alignments, whereas creatures of chaotic or evil alignments have any fast healing that they do have suppressed, and you are considered shaken and sickened until you leave, or if you are immune. I know this will affect at least one of you. With Yuki's involvement, both Yuki and Osa, you will gain that fast healing. Whereas Joseph, I don't think you have any fast healing, but if you would get a fast healing from a spell or material or anything, those no longer work if you're in that plane, and you'll forever be shaken and sickened. I don't think you're immune to those.
No, but I was going to see if we can get Iskandor a scroll so that he can learn the spell that keeps you from taking negative effects from elemental planes and stuff like that.
If that's an FFd20, sure.
Yeah, I know it's in Pathfinder. I don't know if it's an FFd20.
And then finally, creatures that would be lawful evil or chaotic good are just treated as if they're neutral and have no alignment effect on them. So, the only one who's not affected by the alignment stuff is Iskandor, because he is just neutral.
Yeah, so there is a spell for it, but it's a druid spell, unfortunately.
Oh, I'm going to need an item. I don't even think I can get an item of that.
An item that casts the spell?
An item that will give it to me continuously, basically.
What is the spell, Jack B?
I'm just copying it in just to see if it works. The one I can find is Planar Refuge. It's a 7th level druid spell.
Is it just me, or is Jack B an Enter Robotic?
Just you.
You've been cutting out a little bit.
Yeah, you have been cutting out a little bit too, so it could be just your internet connection.
I shall close some tabs.
Too many tabs.
So, I mean, if you got a scroll of that, it would last for a week.
That's true. I could just grab a couple of scrolls. I think I have enough money for that.
Well, actually, it's a better question. What level did druids get? 7th level spells.
Too much information, Jester. You don't want to deal with planes.
13. Yeah, so basically, if you got a scroll of that and you cast it, or I cast it on you, it would work for 13 days.
Okay. I'll probably grab 2 scrolls of that then before we head out.
I don't know if anywhere sells that.
That spell affects an area, not a person. So if you put it in like, say you put this in the market, if you leave the market, you're not going to be in the Planar Refuge anymore.
Can we cast it on a rock and carry the rock?
No. It creates a sphere. It doesn't affect the market itself.
No, that's fine. But that's the only one I know of for planes. It's fine, Joseph. We won't be here forever, and it'll probably get swapped around at some point.
I'm going to be uncomfortable the entire time we're there. Question for the GM. Does freedom of movement prevent any of the stuff from being extra heavy? Like, it's not going to affect the weight, but will it... my movement, is it going to be hampered still and stuff like that?
Just reading it. It doesn't say anything about encumbrance, and it's referring to magic that impedes movement. I would say freedom of movement does not affect your encumbrance and whatnot, so I don't think it's going to work for the gravity effects.
Right, I think I have enough strength to cover all the encumbrance stuff. It's the other stuff on top of that, like the negatives to attacks and stuff like that I'm worried about. The skill checks and the attacks.
I shall do a quick Google search.
Yeah, because if you're being affected by sickened, shaken, and the effects of the plane, it'll be -6 for attacks specifically.
All right.
That's nasty.
It is. But Joseph's got levels in fighter now, right? You'll be fine.
Not yet, I don't. And that's not fighter either.
Oh, what is it?
It'll be Dark Knight.
Oh, are you trying to get that bonus to charisma for your saves?
Yeah.
I'm considering that, but I probably shouldn't.
And at this level, I can hop into grit stance without too much care of the minuscule amount of HP that I'm losing per turn.
True.
Okay, this is the spell that I need.
Alright, I found a wording for it. Freedom movement would remove those penalties from gravity.
Oh, thank goodness. We do not have planar adaptation. Oh, that sucks.
The only thing I don't think it would affect would be weapon ranges, because once the weapon leaves you, it's leaving the freedom movement, but I don't think you have any ranged attacks.
I mean, I have a bow, but I use it like once a year, so...
It does say projectiles remain affected.
Yeah, so even Dutch will still get affected.
Oh, yeah.
So I just need to not pull a Osen's. Start throwing my weapon around. It's okay, I got it. Yeah, so the spell that I would need is Planar Adaptation, but it's not in FFd20 as far as by that name, at least.
She'll have a quick search, see if there is a change of it.
It's a 5th level spell.
The wording doesn't appear in FFd20, so it doesn't appear it's in there.
Great, so planar travel in FFd20 is just screw you guys. I'm going home.
Eh, it's only going to be a minus four to your attack, well, minus six. No, you don't have the, you have the rear move, so yeah, minus four to your attack rolls. Minus four to your attack roll, saves, skills, and ability checks. And then a minus two on weapon damage.
You're going to get plus six from flanking.
What's that?
Gonna get plus six from flanking.
I am? How did I do that?
Well, plus four because I outflank and I have menacing on my weapon now.
Oh.
It's an additional plus two.
That's gonna be fun to work with. Well, I don't like where we're going because it affects me, but I guess that's nothing we can do about that.
It's not gonna affect you forever.
The entire time I'm there.
Yeah, the entire time you're there, but not forever.
It will haunt my dreams forever.
I mean, if you die there and don't get revived, I guess it was forever.
Alright, well, I guess I'll go. Unless Minerva wants to just change my alignment for me.
No.
Ooh, I wonder if there's any spells like that that can temporarily change my alignment.
Sorry, what did I miss?
Not much, just Enchiro is looking for spells to change his alignment.
Oh.
All I need is one step away and I'll be fine.
Just be nicer.
I mean, I literally saved the world. I don't go around, like, killing willy-nilly. Usually do what's best for everybody around me, but I do look out for myself more than others.
As well as those whispers you've sent me. Does anyone have flaming or fire rings as well?
No.
I got a holy ring. Oh, is the shadow enchantment on my weapon going to be affected?
It won't do any damage.
Great.
You have a fire ring, but I'm not wearing it currently.
Then it doesn't matter if you're not wearing it.
Yeah.
It's because the plane has no atmosphere, so both air and fire cannot exist. Well, fire and wind, I should say.
And it said before that I can't. You can't cast dark, fire, or wind spells, right?
Yeah.
Cue every enemy being weak to dark, fire, or wind.
There's a chance if you've never encountered something, you might be weak to it.
Okay.
I mean, this is also their home plane. They're going to be better on their home plane.
Oh, yeah, no. It's just a fact. Okay.
Are we waiting on something? Did I miss something?
I don't know if you're still looking for spells to be getting scrolls and whatnot off.
No, the only thing I could do is permanently change my alignment, which if it hasn't changed already, then that would be metagaming right now, to just change it right now just because.
Kinda.
I feel like if I follow a certain alignment that's vastly different from my own, then the GM can say that it's changed, but that's not something that I would do personally. Unless, like, it was a character that was meant to do that, to be redeemed or whatever, but that's not what this character is, so. I am good to continue at all of my negatives. I will be fine.
I mean, has Condorus had a lot of spells disabled from him?
Yeah, I mean, it makes my turns quicker.
Means you can't do the fiery body spell as well.
I know, that sucks. I'm gonna have to stick with lightning body then.
Shame.
Do I need to stock up on revival stuff?
I have 3 Mega Phoenixes, I believe.
I've got one on me as well.
And I have 3 Megas and 4 Megas and 3 normal Phoenix stones.
Yeah, I could cast revival as well, so I think we're okay.
I know nobody asked, but it's just like a mechanics wise. You going to these realms is counted more like either a calling or just using planar travel. If you die there, you die there. You don't come back to the material plane.
Yeah, I just assume so. We that never happens for mortals anyway, does it? We're not outsiders, are we?
Well, when you go there, you're technically an outsider, but not in type wise, no. Once you leave your plane and go to a different plane, you're an extra planar being. So is everyone good with their current gear setups? Are you ready to go?
Yeah.
I think so.
Yep. Yeah.
I'll let you know when we get there, and I'm not happy with it. And then we get back.
And then you'll teleport back.
I can't yet.
You can't, you're not planning on traveling, yeah.
Not until level 22, no.
Not even level 21 yet.
Exactly, so a while.
Alrighty, as people are prepared to go, we shall have our break here.
Alrighty.
And I shall be right back. Yep, that's the sound. Okay. So, with everybody all aware of where they are going, and fine with their current state of items and the like, Minerva will move you all together and open up a portal. As you all prepare yourselves for a little jaunt between the planes, you all take one last look at the domain of Minerva. The bright lights and colourful scenery definitely is going to be a common sight, though having a final look at the material plane before you go off on a long adventure will definitely help to keep the memory. You're all enveloped in black thriving lines. As they coat each of your bodies, you feel your essence pulled away. A similar feeling to when you would have normal teleportation magic, as you get the feeling you are sinking down and down. The lines cut into your bodies as you are transmuted into forms of energy, whisked away between the planes. You can see the sphere of the material plane in the distance, a ball containing your universe that is so large many would say it is endless. Though from this exterior view you can see one end to the other. So many places to go and so many places to visit. Though instead of visiting your own plane, you are going to another, in the hopes that you can stop what is going across the other planes, and in doing so, protecting your plane from further incursions. Across your material plane sphere, you notice cracks forming across it, slowly being reformed as the deities do their job. It's not a very noticeable change, especially from being set upon Aeon Gaia. But seeing it in its entirety, you can put away maybe just a few thoughts that the deities do nothing. As you whisk away from the material plane, you meteor towards another sphere, made of a blinding yellow and white light. The swirling masses of worlds and stars in the distance show to you how minuscule Aeon Gaia is when compared to all the other planes. While it feels as if it is light years and an immeasurable amount of time between, as Minerva said, they are neighbouring, and a singular spell can take you there within a matter of maybe a minute, or even less, depending on the caster. With many more spheres into the distance, your mind starts to wonder where this journey will take you. But for now, you take the first step, as your material form changes into that of an extraplanar being. When on Aeon Gaia, or even within the Varipros Heights core temple, a place heavily invaded by outsiders and demons, you always felt like you belonged. You may have been uncomfortable or hurt, but your feet were firmly on the ground and you were solidly within your plane. As you stop your movement into the holy plane, your exoplanar form feels as if it's being constantly pushed back, that you should not be here. But whatever thoughts of returning enter into your head, you know you have to see it through. A vast sphere of yellow creeps up in front of you. The numerous stars and planets kind of make it seem an immeasurable task. Though thankfully, through Minerva's magic, you are vaulted towards a particular planet. Though unlike yours, you see little in the way of ocean or grass. Instead, the planet is a swirling mist of both watery vapors and just light. Though watery vapors is all you can think of, as it is completely composed of materials you're not familiar with. You don't see any real water, but that's as best as you could compare it to. As your bodies land upon the, whatever you could call a surface, of the planet, you feel the floor start to burn away the soles of your shoes and sabatons. Your skin, or whatever is exposed, starts to feel as if somebody's placing a fire to you. You're being burned alive, but your either your deific power or just the power of being at the peak of mundane might allows you to survive the caustic nature. Throughout all of you, however, Yuki seems to be the most well-adjusted to this plane. The energies seep into her skin, as instead of burning alive, you see as if she's rejuvenated, possibly even a few years younger. She's filled with energy, and could go through several days without tiring. And on the other spectrum, Joseph, feels even more an outsider here. If ever he would call himself a demon, now would be the time. His essence puts a dirty mark on this plane made of yellows and whites, as his own skin starts to crack and at some points even starts to bleed as the plane starts to tear away at him. Though you know he's in no immediate danger, he definitely shows off a heavy sign of discomfort. And in the middle ground is both Osa and Iskandor. Osa has a small amount of ease here. If anything, it may remind her of the divine powers of the Aether Tree. Though she was never too close to it, she does have a remembrance of its power and how it has the good of all within it. And whereas Iskandor, who is a mesh of both flesh and metal, he could swear his metal was getting hotter the more he spent here. And even if some may see him as a cyborg abomination, the plane itself accepts him for who he is. Or at least for what he is currently. Since there's always a chance he could slip into a more profane alignment.
What? We didn't discuss this.
You don't know what that scratching your back of your head is. And as you all land on the light platforms beneath your feet, they are solid enough to keep you up. However, everyone will need to make a fortitude save, please.
Good thing I installed those eyes. Right.
The eyes explode out of your retinas.
Restart my sheet. Give me 2 seconds.
For mechanical purposes, the shaken is fear any, right?
Yes.
All right, I've already got those both ticked.
Okay.
Oh yeah, so I can't fail unless I roll the one as well. 15, that's fine.
As you look around, you all start to squint at the bright lights surrounding you. There's no real sun or any lamps or fires around. It's just the entire area is made of physical light. You feel as if somebody has just thrown open the curtains to the windows, and it is a constant feeling. Maybe for Iskandor it's a bit better since his eyes aren't real, but he still feels the burning sensation. Nope, I'm taking your save as that. You failed.
Alright.
You're able to still see, as far as the eyes can see, a mass of, you could call them planes, but it's just a mostly flat surface of yellow. You can't call it brick or anything, it's just planes of light. You know they're solid because they are a darker hue. There are several places that are a lighter hue, and you could swear if you were to misstep, you could fall either to the center of this planet or very far beneath. At which point, everyone could make a perception check, please.
It sucks not having our little characters that we can just click on and do that.
I can put you in the bottom right if you wish. You'll just be floating in the void between the planes.
I figured it out. How did Iskandor get higher perception than me?
Got new eyes? I don't know.
Put points in it.
And he rolled a 1.
Putting points of perception? That's never what you do. You never use that skill. As you look around, the endless masses of yellow, you're all easily able to pick out a path that could lead you onwards. Though from here, you could call it a mist, but it's just particles of light dancing across the space in front of you. Almost kind of blocks your view any further than a mile, so you're unsure of how far you are from the capital city. though you're pretty sure the Minerva wouldn't have placed you too far away.
Is there any way we can sort of divine a direction to go to for this city?
Well, you were teleported facing a particular direction.
Oh, so
that's as best
go...
as you... yeah.
Well, fair enough.
Go
sorry,
forward.
I catch that. Yeah. I'll just got mage robes on. The rest of it will come with time. We're not expecting a fight, I assume, right now. Or do you want buffs?
Well, we have no idea what to expect right now, right?
True.
For now, I say we head down and then assess the area.
Joseph is just sitting in a corner, just scratching. Eyes wide, nearly foaming at the mouth.
I will cast Greater Heroism on Joseph then, because it'll make you immune to fear, which should get rid of your shaken, and it'll give you a bit of a boost that you might need.
You can sort of look towards Joseph.
Does the fear go away?
Yeah, shaken will go away if you cast shaken on you. If you cast heroism on you,
double shaken.
I just take a deep breath. I'm like, oh, that's better for now. Thank you, Iskandar.
That's fine. That'll last for 24 minutes. Sorry.
Yuki will sort of look over and be like, "Is he always that itchy?"
I think it's the effect of the flame.
Also, we'll go to Joseph and just kind of crouch next to him and just be there with him. You doing good, Joe?
I'm better now. It's something about this place is just against the core of my being.
Are you both wearing your rings at the moment?
Yes.
Yeah, but also has her gauntlets on, so it's probably hidden.
Okay.
We'll just try to be quick here then.
Indeed. No, I'm not going to teleport there. We'll walk.
Yes, teleporting to a place you have no memory of.
No, I mean like using the location and then teleporting to it.
Suddenly, we end up in the Shadow Realm.
He doesn't have plane, I'll travel.
I'm dreaming, okay?
Not yet.
I mean, I could always alter his spell. Pray I don't alter it further.
Would that work, discern location and finding the city in question, or should we just walk? I think we just walk.
I think we just walk. We have a direction-ish.
Yeah, we'll do that. That works for me. I'll also cast Fly Mass on everyone, because that's 10 minutes per level, so it's like a ridiculous amount of time. So, just in case you fall into a gap, then you can fly.
As you throw up Fly Mass, everyone will definitely notice that it feels a bit more difficult to utilize it due to the heavier gravity.
Yeah. So it'd be harder to fly, I assume, like the spell, the skill check even.
Yeah.
Alright.
As well as it's a question to ask now, if not any other time. Does anyone change their encumbrance from having all of their gear doubled in weight?
I do.
I have not yet.
No, but if anyone needs anything to carry, feel free, because I have probably about 300 weight left over to use. Before I even... Well, actually, no, that's not even if I go into medium. I have like 600 weight to use.
I'm just below light.
Yeah.
Well, Osa's carrying like 3 bags of holding, isn't she?
Yeah.
What's your point?
That's probably just bringing her down.
I mean, I just double my total at this time, right? If it's everything, it's double weight.
Yeah. Just
so that would be, I would be just a little bit below lightweight.
Out of curiosity, Iskandar's fly mass. What fly speed is that?
It's 20, it's not impressive.
Okay. My
it's
flies.
Just perfect maneuverability.
Sorry, I was just seeing if it overwrites my fly speed, but it doesn't.
Oh. Got your own fly speed. I see.
60 foot.
Are you a Hume?
Yes.
Yeah. Fair enough.
That did nobody question to this point what race Yuki was.
Well, she looked like a Hume. Yeah.
No one's really questioned her anything. They've just tagged her along as a hero of light.
Well, yeah, you've come with high recommendation.
We would know she's a hero of light, right? Because we recognize all heroes.
Yeah.
We can sense that.
We know you're a hero of light.
Are you doubting the word of your lady? I never told you I'm a hero of light.
Well, we don't doubt it.
Well, that just basically adds to it.
Yeah.
We know you're a hero of light, and we know we'll watch for you, so... good enough for me.
Exactly.
While we're obviously walking in the direction we're walking, is there any being or creature or anything around that potentially we could ask for directions?
As you question that, you can roll Knowledge Planes.
Did I put points in that? Plus 43, jeez. Do you even need to roll?
Maybe.
Well, for enemy traits, there is a...
oh, yeah.
Increasing limit, but... so what I just asked right now, no, he doesn't need to roll. But then he doesn't get to see the high numbers if he doesn't roll.
Exactly.
Very true.
Alright, so... Joseph and Iskandor, as your group is moving forwards and you try and see through the... we'll call it mist, it's not exactly a mist. You can tell that this is because... you're used to looking on a material plane where you normally have the atmosphere and lights and whatnot. But you're currently not adjusted to this area. And so your vision is essentially very close to that of... like having dark vision, you can only see to a certain extent. As you move forward, you can see what's up ahead of you. And if you look back, it kind of like goes with you with your sphere of vision. And to that point, you can't really make out any other beings near you besides the pseudo road beneath your feet. And if there were any other beings, they would spot you before you would spot them.
Unfortunately, we're going to have to just proceed as normal. Our senses won't work as well as we'd like here.
Yeah, Joseph is going to be walking along on the ground. Because he can do that much faster than the 20-foot fly speed. So I'm going to go with that.
Yeah, same, because it only affects our speed if we get encumbered or something, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so walking as well.
Oh, I thought it also affected our speed just outright.
The gravity will only affect your speed if it's affecting your encumbrance because of such.
Ah, okay. Either way, I'm still way faster on the ground. Now that I got that 60-foot move speed constantly.
As you continue moving forward, the area surrounding you starts to become a buzz with sound. And a buzz is an apt word, as it definitely sounds like a buzzing noise. At which point, Iskandor can hear the Enochian language, but he just left.
Should be back, said 2 seconds.
Yeah! How dare he
be late? I count that as 4 seconds.
Rude.
Oh, you said, okay. As you're moving forwards, everyone can hear a buzzing noise, but Iskandor, you can hear the Enochian language.
Ah, what's it say?
It seems some of these planar beings have noticed your party, and they are talking amongst themselves, describing what you look like. And they are quick to assume you guys are demons.
I'll relay to the party that we're under watch, and I'll reply in Enochian that we are no threat, loudly, and that we're here on a diplomatic mission.
As you shout into the mass of light, you would have probably hoped to have heard the rustling of bushes, but there's no such thing here. You instead hear the whirring of, not exactly wind, but a pressure, as you could roll, but you're gonna get it. You're pretty sure those beings either transmuted themselves into more fluid light, or they teleported.
Okay. Well, we know, they know we're here. But that's not really a problem, we're not trying to be hidden. Let's just keep an eye out if we can. And an ear. Wait, how long does tongues last?
I was just about to ask Eskandor, can we get tongues cast on us?
You guys can't cast tongues? What?
Sadly, that doesn't fall under my ability.
I can actually cast tongues on you for 240 minutes.
So 2 hours?
Yeah. Actually, no, it's divided.
4 hours.
Sorry, oh, no, it's divided.
So 1 hour each? Well, yeah, if it's three of them, that's a bit weird.
Yeah, we'll just call it an hour each, if you're cool with that.
Yeah.
You could do that right now, but like next time we have conversations would maybe be better. I don't know.
Well, if they already think we might be demons, then casting spells when they're next to us might not
might be...
Yeah, might be a bit sus. Also,
it gives you the chance to hear them, because you don't know Enochian.
I didn't hear anything speaking, so it was just buzzing.
Yeah, that's... It's kind of what it say. That is the language of Enochian. Wait, I realized that if I responded, did I just buzz back?
Yeah.
So, it's going to explain, it's a language of celestial beings, Enochian. If I cast tongues on you, you might be able to hear it.
They speak like bees.
They speak... He kind of gestures with his hands. Differently, should we say. Similar to how Infernal is guttural, Enochian is more high-pitched, shall we say.
Sure.
Yeah, sure.
Well, you seem to know their tongue, so I guess you take the lead with the talking.
Doing tongues. That's why I'm doing tongues, so you can talk. It's fine.
Yeah, we just told you not to cast it when they already think we're demons.
I'm saying if we have to cast it, we cast it now instead of right when they're at us. So we are not casting spells when they already think we might be a threat, because they might not know what we're casting.
Oh, fair enough. Cast it away then.
Yep. I will pop it on all of you. I take it you're not resisting, Chester?
Nope.
And yeah, you'll get tongues for an hour.
He casts Finger of Death on Chester.
Yeah, that was three deaths on Joseph. I needed saves. I'm actually the final boss. Yeah,
two months all over again. I mean, who?
Well, Joseph is feeling pain in a realm of goodness, so he's obviously evil, so kill him.
That's how it works. And I'm true neutral, so obviously I have no feelings whatsoever.
Yeah. Just got a pinky gray. He's like quarter, but yeah. He's got... Don't you have a brain implant?
Yeah, I've got a brain, ears...
Yeah, which is like the main part, because you are your brain, you're not your body.
Weirdly enough, I've also
got... I mean,
got
for the man that decided to go true seeing in a demon realm, I wouldn't be surprised if he did turn out to be the final boss.
What?
Yeah.
Insanity level 100.
You guys could kill me, probably.
Iskandor, roll bluff!
Wait, it's actually quite high now.
No.
You already had your chance of killing Oza.
And he took it. You just survived.
Yeah, you only got halfway through.
Oh, yeah. I forgot about that. I didn't even count that as an attempt. That was like a...
Did you realize you almost killed Oza?
That was just a spare spell he was just throwing around randomly. He wasn't even trying to kill you.
It was just a temper tantrum.
It was the warning shot.
I was like, in that moment, it was really good at the time, but I was literally like, shit, I need to cast a spell. And it was just like, what's the first one I see? Ultima, that one. Yeah, that'll be fine. You survived. I don't know what you're complaining about.
I'm not complaining. Just pointing it out.
Just making you aware that you almost killed him. He felt bad about that, don't worry. Yeah, that should be it. Should we continue on? I guess. I'm almost tempted to use True Seeing. Now you've mentioned it.
Yeah, I was thinking the same thing.
You're on mental health.
Oh no.
My mental health's shot anyway. Apparently I've become a hero of light, lost, like, become uninsane. Then got attacked by creepy demon skeletal finger, so I'm probably insane again. No, it's not worth using yet. We'll just continue on.
Ah, okay.
Well, now you maybe want to use it. But no, for my own life, for now, I'll be fine.
As you continue onwards with the aid of tongues, sadly, it doesn't give you any immediate benefits, as there is no more buzzing or Enochian language coming your way. Instead, the sound is replaced with that of the closest you could correlate it to would be shifting rock, but it sounds more like just the light is vibrating heavy enough that it's creating a low tone, at which point you can roll knowledge planes. I don't think you need that text of I'm helping anymore, Joseph, because you pretty much auto-succeed.
Do I need to roll?
If you want to see a high number, but no, you don't.
No, because I can make it higher if I want to, but I'm not going to.
Well, I'm not going to tell you any more information. Alright, so both Joseph and Iskandor, you realise that is the shifting of the more physical elements of the plane, and at your best guess, which you're pretty sure is correct, some buildings off in the distance are being moved away.
Oh, so are they moving the city, do we think?
They are moving the city, but it's not going away from you. It's going to the left and right as if it's making a corridor.
Ah. Maybe there's something coming through it. Better get some eyes on then. Shit, I didn't pick up prying eyes. Well, we're going to have to look at that realise then. Well, your realise, mine are...
Yeah, I was about to say, you don't have your realise. You sold those.
I mean, they look pretty normal. They're just a bit green. But yeah, should we press on?
Yeah, sure.
As you move onwards, the low rumbling noise continues until the buildings seem to settle to the far left and right of you. Your vision slowly increases over time, but the mass of particles still persist in the distance. However, you start to see the exterior of some of the buildings. Though most of them are spherical in design, they all seem to have a waviness to their outline. As you know, they aren't fully physical, they are shifting all the time. And in the path ahead of you, you can see a mass of light come up from the floor and then form into a humanoid figure in front of you. They speak over to you as your ears kind of twitch and burn slightly at the voice, though with tongues you all can understand what they say. Outsiders, what brings you to our home and our plane?
have been sent here from our home plane, from the goddess Minerva, in a sort of a diplomatic mission. We are on our way to the main city here. Maradorma? I can't really say it very well.
Maradorma. You had it right.
We mean you and your people no harm.
Well, if it is the city of Maradorma you seek, you have found it. But the city does not accept outsiders so willingly. There have been many incursions from the outside planes of destruction, and we will not allow such to continue. If you truly mean no harm, prostrate yourself to the floor and pray to your god.
Well, my one true god is Bahamut, and should I ever require to pray to him, I always will take the opportunity. To which Yuki will kneel down and pray to Bahamut.
I will, as well, I will get down on my knees and I will just kind of whisper a quick prayer to Minerva, asking for her guidance or help if she could possibly get it, because I have no idea what to do.
After praying, Yuki will sort of put her head up and say, "You mentioned incursions onto your plane. Now, we're here, as Joseph just said, on a diplomatic terms, trying to prevent these incursions from happening. Would you be willing to offer your guidance and support so we can aid you in reducing these incursions?"
Does Osa prostrate and pray as well?
Yeah, she does.
Any particular deity?
Minerva.
And what of Iskandor?
Sorry, what was that?
One of the denizens of Maradorma showed themselves and asked who you were, and said that they've had incursions of outsiders, bringing destruction with them, and that if you guys aren't here for destruction, that you have to prostrate yourself and pray to your deity.
Iskandor doesn't really have a deity. Is there any other way I can show that I'm not like that?
You can just give it to Minerva.
You don't even have to think of it as a prayer, just like talk to her.
Like a pledge of loyalty or something.
Also, with your planes, you're pretty sure she's just, this denizen's just asking you to do this because most demons and devils won't do that.
Oh, yeah. If it's just a case of there doesn't have to be real feeling behind it, then I will, you know, do a prayer of some description. Be it short, almost like a kind of Lord's Prayer, and then go back.
Very well. You do not seem to be outwardly hostile, but know we have many eyes upon you. Even if you speak the Enochian tongue, we do not accept outsiders too willingly. As to your mission of here to fight the outsiders, they have all been washed away by our might, as well as those of our beasts. Why'd you come here now, after the events?
What was Minerva asking again? Was it to prevent incursions happening on her plane?
It was to try and understand what these incursions are, where they're coming from, and stop them, so that it doesn't actually go onto ours here.
Yeah, okay.
We're kind of hunting for the source, I think.
We're more looking for information. I know that you have resisted the incursions onto your plane, but we're looking at it more as a whole, trying to figure out the source as to where they came from and what they are.
And stop them from happening in the future.
We require audience with the Elder Monk. Is that Gruxwald?
Gruxwald.
Gruxwald, sorry. I don't know if I can even say his name in Enochian, but
No.
We are not able to pronounce his true name. We believe he has some knowledge that may benefit us, if possible.
If you seek an audience with the eldest, you may not find, if you are here to combat us, that you'll leave with all of your pieces. But if you're willing to do so, you may follow me and I shall take you to the monastery. All that I ask is that you place your weapons within one of those extra-dimensional bags of your ally. He then moves his hand as he points over to Osa.
Iskandor will hold his materia, but put the staff in there, yeah.
I will open up my little pocket handkerchief and slide my falcata in there. Look like I'm stabbing myself, but
is that your
portable hole?
Yeah, you have to open up the portable hole fully, I'm pretty sure.
You do not.
I'll have a read.
Upon seeing Joseph's little trick, Yuki will sort of head up and be like, "Ah, you have a portable hole as well. I have one of my own." To which she'll open hers up and put her Buster Sword in it.
My axe would also be better off in a hole rather than in the back. Because you're not really supposed to put sharp things in the back.
It's available if you want to use mine. However, I fully understand if you would rather use Joseph's. You two seem quite accustomed together.
The portable hole is vague because it says when it's fully opened, but sure, it doesn't really matter in this case. You just put it in the handkerchief.
Yeah, it's nothing personal, really. It's just habit, I guess. She'll hand over the axe to put in Joseph's portable hole.
Yuki will fold up her portable hole. No, it's none taken. I fully understand. So, I haven't...
What's this Condor's sense motive for?
I fully understand.
So you want to learn more.
As you finally put all of your weapons into the bags and portable holes, everyone can make a perception check. Everyone gets it, okay. With the weapons fully stored away, and to the point where you'd have to spend some time to get them back out, you can see that the being of light in front of you starts to become a lot more darker in color as if he's solidifying, at which point you can recognize that he was making himself a more difficult target, but now that you're unarmed, he's letting his guard down, essentially.
I assume you'll make your way. We haven't got your name. Would you happen to have one?
The being speaks a word and it just kind of burns your ear and you don't understand it.
Yuki will sort of look towards his Iskandor and be like, "Did you understand that one?"
Did I understand that?
No.
No, I do believe that it was a language beyond mortal comprehension.
Ah, well, thank you for that clarification. I do apologize to you that I can't fully comprehend your name, but I will tell you mine. I am Yuki. That is what you can refer to me as.
At which point, the being will give you their material name, which is Vexaka.
Ah, much easier to comprehend. Well, I appreciate you.
If you are ready, I shall lead you to the monastery. This way. You need not worry about the floor. The city's floor is all solidified.
Please.
and instead of turning around, their body just kind of like shifts, and they just move back. And following along with the, as far as you can guess, they're just Severati. You will move past several other buildings, at which point you can hear the low rumbling noise yet again, as the city is reforming itself into what you could just guess was its original formation. The buildings get closer to you, at which point you can see more of their design, though the design seems very otherworldly to you as it's ever-shifting. You will also notice that there is very little in the way of windows. Nobody cares to look outside. Though, you can see through some of the walls, so it's possible they don't even need windows, they can just see through the walls. And on the opposite spectrum of such, you approach a... it's a tall monastery, it's not a large one. The monastery, being one of the few places that actually has greenery, has a few glass windows with some potted plants on the exterior. Though, you cannot recognize the plants, and you're pretty sure you don't... You couldn't use them for any medicines for yourself. Which point I'll move you to the map. Entering into the monastery, one of the Serivati that brought you here, Vasaka, will move to one of the green carpets towards the north. This place's design is, in best of your vision, looks like this. You're pretty sure there is no wood beneath you and there are no carpets. It's as best as what you can mine and put it together, rather than just having a sight of everything that's just yellow. And on the eastern part of the monastery is a larger, more whiter severity. They would have stood, but instead their form just phases in and out a bit until they get taller, to the point where you could assume they're more standing. There's a quick conversation between Vasaka and Goldsfault, and you do know they're speaking in Enochian, though they are speaking in the original speed, which is very quick, and it's basically Vasaka just giving the details to Goldsfault. The elder would then address you.
Beings from another plane, you come here seeking diplomacy and peace, though you also speak of the same outsider threat we have faced. Do you bring such again to our doorstep in a fleeing motion, or are you here to follow them back to theirs?
Yuki will take a step forward. By all means, we mean no harm, and it is a pleasure to meet you, Goxbolt. We are seeking information about these beings that came to your plane and seeks to destroy it. We look to stop any future issues that could potentially come off this, so we're looking towards a source, maybe a place of where they may have come. And we're coming to you for, hopefully, some knowledge upon this subject.
So you have come here for the deep dark. This plane is not home to darkness or shadow. And even if they were to appear, they are gone almost instantly. But with those outside of vermin invading this plane, a taint has been left here. Some of our kin have gained knowledge they should not have. Ours is the domain of testing the light and the holy magics. But they perverse it with necromancy and darkness. You seek those.
How is that even possible? Your plane denies the abilities of such spells.
That it does, Caster. But... these planes are created by the deities. It is not an impossibility for them, or anything that they create.
Do you believe this is the work of a villain of darkness or a similar being?
There's always a possibility that a being created by deity could do these things, if it is a villain of darkness or otherwise. But the fact that they are here means that it could be.
So you say that they've now left this plane. Did you destroy them, or did they flee?
We destroyed the outsiders that invaded our realm, as they are much weaker than our kin, especially the monks that I train. However, there were numerous of them. It took us time to rebuild and recover, and many of our kin are now in their child forms. But there are still beings that way.
The outsiders are still on your plane?
Not the outsiders in particular, but the taint that they brought. It has corrupted some of our Serevati kin.
I see. Do you believe by cleansing your corrupted kin that it could prevent this, or we could find some further information on why the planes have been invaded in this way? And I must ask, have any of your brethren or yourself heard laughing? Like a demented laugh, as though something is moving things around a board.
I do not think this. I know this. I can see and feel the tether that they left and where they went. If you remove the taint on this plane, I shall give to you the knowledge of where they went.
Would you be able to take us to the location of this taint?
No, I must stay within the capital. Even if the outsiders may be gone, I need to protect this place.
Where would the location be? I'm sure we can find it.
And she'll gift on to you the Zarka. They can guide you.
Joseph, Osa, you seem in meditation or quiet. Are you well?
I'm fine. I'm just... Yuki just sort of stepped forward and was taking control of things. I was letting her do her thing.
Apologies.
That's fine.
My sincere apologies. I'm used to being on my own. I usually take missions solo. So this is just a common problem that I face. Feel free to please speak over or to take over if you need to.
If I feel I need to, I will. But I don't feel like I need to speak over anybody. We're all sent here for the same purpose, and as part of the same group, we share in our responsibilities.
I've never been much for talking.
True enough. Apologies, Yuki. Please, continue.
What was the name of the being he was giving or having Vizarka. Take us there?
Vizarka.
Oh, it was Vizarka. Okay. Would I be able to identify which one Vizarka was again?
A lot of these people look the same to you. Though you know where they sat down, so yes.
Okay. I'll sort of look towards where Vizarka sat down then and say, Vizarka, would you be kind enough to take us to the location?
Vizarka does not respond, however, Gulk's fault will intervene. Before you set off on this journey, and before I send Vizarka possibly to his renewal, I must test that you have the strength to be able to defeat those I send you after. Vizarka is a close ally of mine, and I would hate to lose his conscience.
I understand. What would you have us do?
There are four monks here. Their age is grand, and they do not particularly mind if they were to disperse. They shall test you within this monastery.
Can I request permission that we gain our weapons back before this test?
You may do so.
To which Yuki will open her portable hole and pull out her Buster Sword, and then strap it to her back.
I will pull out Osa's and my weapons and hand her hers. Actually, as soon as it's visible, she could just recall it, can't she?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I take it this will be a combat test, Guxwald, or will it be a test of wit and will?
It shall be for might. For the things you are facing will most likely not give you a chance to speak.
I see that. Well, let us be about it.
With your weapons in hand, or staff, or I guess that staff is a weapon, yeah. Four of the Zivarati will move out from what you could just assume to be large cushions, but they're not really that. We'll move to the middle of the floor.
Yuki will sort of turn her head back towards the party. I know not of what all of your abilities are, besides just a quick glance over, I can assume what roles you assume. But I hope we two try and work together. Maybe we can form up some sort of team.
Speaking of which... I take a long, hard look at Yuki.
Your sword, you're a frontliner, right?
I can tight it. Yes, I am a frontline fighter. And then I'll just write down what everything is.
Just look for any openings and I'm sure we'll manage. And
yeah, actually, just drums on that big sword of her.
She's actually a bard.
Yeah.
Actually a black mage. This is just all a ruse.
She's actually just an illusion. Yeah, dang it.
Just glamoured up.
Level 21? Jesus.
Yeah, I'm tell you, he's cheating.
Don't get too worried if I don't respond verbally while we're fighting. I can get a bit of a tunnel vision.
I can get the idea. You're not much of a talker, but you certainly look like a capable fighter. I will try to stay out your way.
Gog's fault. Well, actually, no, not Gog's fault. The Serevati monks who've moved up are also going to ask if you're going to keep your buffs active or if you're going to disable them.
We don't have any.
You got Fly Mass.
And I've
got Heroism on Joseph.
Yeah, that too.
Because
if you are keeping those, they're going to use their own.
No, we can always start unbuffed. That's not a problem. Because otherwise, we're going to have to go through the whole rigmarole. Unless you guys want to start buffed, it's up to you.
What's the question being asked? Are you saying, like, it gives this Kandor the chance to buff the party and they buff themselves, or they just both go unbuffed?
Yeah, that's the question.
That's down to Iskandor.
Well, it's up to you guys, really.
Well, it's down to the group as well. If wants to face a buffed enemy whilst they're also buffed, or if you want to be on an equal playing field. Because you don't know what spells they have.
Yeah. Nope. Well, I'm happy to be unbuffed or either way. I mean, they've got to spend their turns buffing.
Well, let's put it this way. If we come across somebody and they attempt to ambush us, we're not going to be 100% buffed.
Exactly.
So why don't we start off as if we were just... Is it possible for me to drop the heroism on myself? Or is that something I could just ask Iskandor to do? Or
Heroism should be dismissible.
Yeah, I can dismiss it from you. That's fine.
I'll just double check. No, heroism is not dismissible.
Dispel it then, I guess.
Was it greater heroism?
Yeah.
Yes.
So it's
Since it's only minutes, it would have ended by now.
Okay.
Cool. I can dispel fly, I'm pretty sure.
Fly. Fly itself is dismissible. How about mass? I would assume yes. Fly mass, not dismissible. actually, I think this is just a Pathfinder spell. Let's have a look there. I don't know if that's just a case of copy-pasting, it doesn't add the D back onto it. No, fly in Pathfinder is also not dismissible. I don't know why ours is. Yeah, you'd have to dispel that. In which case, when you dispel your own spells, I'm pretty sure you can just auto-succeed.
Yeah, just
go. Or you get like a plus 10 or whatever.
Yeah, which I'm pretty sure will do it.
No.
If I'm targeting that particular ability.
You're allowed to keep tongs, by the way.
That's fine. I just need to pay the 4 MP, well, the 4 casts of Dispel, then I take it in MP.
Unless you just want to use Dispel Greater, unless you don't have that.
Oh no, I have Dispel Greater, so I can just do the area once, that's fine.
Yeah, because you only need to get rid of one spell.
Yeah, that's fine. I'll go down to, like, still a lot of MP, that's not a problem. Yep, good to go.
Alrighty, roll some initiative.
Why? The two frontline fighters roll a 20.
I mean,
just ready to go.
We are really ready to go. Girl power.
The two good tushes.
The
20, 20. Good people this party.
Okay then.
I'll break out the deck chair.
Hey, unfortunately, Yuki doesn't have any teamwork feats, but she can get them.
That's fine. She hasn't seen us fight yet, so she that's
exactly.
Fair
she, that doesn't even know about it.
Also, did say to keep an eye for openings.
She did.
Their turns did not get added to the turn order. Did group init just break?
Maybe.
Strange. Well, I rolled it, so I could just type these in. Just like you guys, I got 2 crits on my initiative.
How dare you? The GM isn't allowed crits.
Banned.
Alright, and as you face off against these fellows, you can roll Knowledge Planes to identify them.
Oh yeah!
I don't have that!
Here comes the triple roll. Good thing I fucking did.
How many ranks do you have into Knowledge Planes?
20.
So you get 4 extra, okay.
I thought it'd be, you know, appropriate with the title of the adventure.
Just bear with me. My traits button is on my other character. Here we go. Yuki Tempest Leo.
Is this when we find out that Yuki is actually the long lost adopted sister of
Leo? No, far from that.
It's his mother.
Yes. I don't actually know who's older. I think Leo might actually be younger. Yeah, Leo's younger.
Okay. These are Zeravati monks. They are humanoids, comprised wholly of holy energies and lights, almost transparent at times. While it is made up of energy, its feet are firmly planted on the ground. Mere look at the creature causes most to squint their eyes at their radiance, and you can learn 9 traits.
I take it we're just going for the liver. I would say probably not has magic, maybe resistances. But what do you guys think? Because it's pretty, I think it's pretty obvious they're going to have magic.
They did say they could do buffs as well. They're all white monks.
Oh, they could be.
So you're sticking with that list, but you're changing has magic to resistances?
Yeah, if everyone else is cool with that.
Yep, I'm good.
Yep.
Alrighty.
Give me Urn Memento.
Can't remember, does DR type give you the DR number, or is it just the type?
Just the type.
Just the type.
Okay.
Alrighty. Their weakest save is Reflex. They have a weakness to Shadow, just like Jaggy was asking for. They have immunity to Fatigue, Exhaustion, Poison, Paralysis, and Sleep. They have all-around vision, where they basically just see all around them and cannot be flanked. They have an Anatomy of Light, which gives them any attacks made against them a 20% mischance, though they do have a Nucleus, which Heartseeker can target. They have holy attacks, where their unarmed attacks go against touch AC, and they can attack incorporeal creatures normally. Their battle tactics is that they surround individual targets. Their DR type is overcome by nothing, and they have no resistances. And first up is going to be Yuki.
You got that clang sound effect ready?
Yeah.
I don't have that. Well,
no,
to
I
be
haven't.
Fair, that's Osa's ability. Depends if she treats her as a pack yet or not. Yuki's very new. Okay. Let's go for the first part. Let's just go with health for now. So as a swift action, I'm giving myself a +8 morale bonus to constitution.
Jeez, that's awesome.
Soldiers are very strong.
And then I'm going to charge at this one. Why is there like another 0 added on the end of that ruler?
Ah. I don't know. They have been updating Roll 20, so.
Okay. There it is.
Strange. Not sure why. All right. As you charge at that Severati, you bring down your braver sword, and as you do so, the Severati flows backwards.
Sadly, do not have step up and strike, so it's a shame. Okay, well, I guess I just slam into the floor. Or what is potentially a floor.
What? Just out of curiosity, what is that that allows them to do that?
That's a good question.
There's a lot of stuff that can let you
do that. There's a lot of things that could do that.
I know there's a fence or a thing that lets you do that.
Yeah. There's so many.
But the question is, are you allowed to use the weapons strike if that happens?
It's alright, now that I know that, I know what I'm doing next turn.
You don't need to actually use your attack, Yuki.
Yeah. Well, I just won't use it then.
Yeah. It interrupts your charge, so you can just not... You can, like, start bringing your sword down. It's like, oh, okay, I won't do that.
Yeah. Just a very disappointed face. Kind of confused as well. Question, would I still be able to get a swift action at the end of that?
You use your swift action to use make...
Yeah. Good point, I forgot about that. Yeah, all good.
That was going to be my question. If that happens, are you allowed to use the weapon strike if you charge?
Are you allowed to do what?
If Yuki had had the weapon strike, would she had allowed to use that after a charge?
Let's have a look, see, step up and strike.
Which then leads me on to my next question. After that attack, will I still get a free action? Because that can be used at any point in your turn, yeah?
Yeah, you would.
Okay, can I give my martial flexibility to give me a free action of step up? Which would then link to that question, because if so, can I then potentially move up at the same time?
Seven strike is against an adjacent foe, and they do this to interrupt the charge, so I'll say no, you can't do step up.
Okay, but I will still use my free action to just gain it.
Okay.
So we'll start with a good old rage and mark Joseph and Yuki as her pack, because Yuki seems more capable in a fight than Iskandar in like melee combat, so that makes sense.
Rude.
I mean, so if you want to get in there, punching
what does that actually do again? What's the benefits?
Nothing, because they're immune to flanking.
Nice. But is that the bit that allows you to flank from any... You don't have to be, like, opposite.
As long as you're adjacent with another member of the pack, you're considered to be flanking that creature.
Okay, good to know.
But right now it doesn't matter because we cannot flank them, so that takes, like, the entire strategy out of the game.
He doesn't know it yet.
She'll figure it out eventually. She'll just see also get like this super like intense look in her eyes and just kind of look towards Joseph, look towards you, and then pinpoint her gaze towards the enemy. And she will not charge, just move up here. And go for an attack. -2 because of the gravity stuff.
Yeah, as you go for the attack, they will also do the 5 step.
Can I do step up and strike?
Yes.
I'll do that. Do I need a new attack roll?
No, we can take that one. You're part seeker. Alrighty.
I do.
You slam into the Severati. Though you know you're doing less damage than normal.
As usual at this point.
Alrighty. Goes to the monk that 5-footed away from Yuki. They are going to 5-foot up again. And they are going to full attack Yuki.
Question. How many attacks?
Four.
Okay. Firstly, I have... Do they go through my mischance for my cloak of displacement?
I actually need to check one of their other things. What percentage is it?
20%.
Yes, they go through that.
Okay, Yuki is going to attempt to parry and riposte one of the attacks.
Is that attack opportunity, or is it swift immediate action, or what?
Uses one of my attacks of opportunity.
So it doesn't take a immediate action to do so, then? Because there are some counter attacks that take an immediate action.
I'm just reading it, hang on. Yeah, it is an immediate action, riposte is.
Okay, so you won't have a swift for next turn?
Yep, that's fine.
Okay. Okay, you want to parry, which you need to roll a higher attack than their attack, yes?
50. That's a really low roll.
You indeed parry the first blow.
Cool. That'll be it. That is... Fine, yep.
you have riposte, so you can damage them back, yeah?
Yes, so just take the damage for that one. For the attack that I did.
Alrighty. What is Yuki's touch AC?
It is 20.
Okay, you are hit 3 times for 98 and 18 holy. This one is going to acrobatics. What is Yuki's CMD?
51.
Alright, you can have attack opportunity on that one.
If the first one hits, which I'm feeling it might do, the second one will also attack.
It does indeed.
And are these things immune to trips?
Jesus Christ.
You don't know.
Well, if that crit confirm roll trips it, basically. So it does 62 trip it.
Second, just doing crit damage.
That's fine.
They are not tripped.
And do both attacks hit?
Yes.
Thank you. Heal for 12. And lastly, I need a 31 fort DC save. Otherwise, is it immune to stuns? It's not immune to a stun.
It didn't seem to be.
Hopefully it's stunned then.
What's the DC for the save?
31. If it saves, then it's staggered instead.
It saves.
Then it is staggered.
I need to check what staggered does.
I think it's only one action.
It's one move or one standard.
Yeah.
Single action.
3 rounds.
He moves, so doesn't get another turn. Okay. I don't know if I have a staggered icon. Never. The one up top is going to attack Osa.
Huh?
I don't think I need to ask you where AC is.
Nope.
Never know.
Pretty sure at this level we'd need to fumble to miss.
You'll get hit 4 times for 146 and 34 holy.
Cool.
They hit hard.
And because darkness doesn't work, I'm pretty sure my armor won't work.
Correct.
That was 4 attacks, so.
Joseph.
I'm gonna try to do normal stuff. I'm just gonna move up to the one directly behind Yuki. And then I'm going to make a regular attack against it.
Uh-huh.
No benefits from flanking, right?
Correct.
If I miss due to mischance, I do have blind fight now, so reroll the mischances on those.
Wow.
Well, indeed. Second person to crit their crit chance. Crit there, crit confirm.
If only we were doing additive crits.
Mm-hmm.
Burst right. Damage, bitches.
Wait, then 20 at that, Yuki. Still only got an 18.
I did.
That's a lot of damage.
It's not that much, because there's no precision damage. The fire materia damage is not applicable.
Don't you get
shadow
sneak attack when you move 10 foot?
Oh, yeah, you're right, I do. I forgot about the skirmisher.
As you move up, Yuki can see Joseph shank into the Severati that attacked her didn't attack her previously, that she staggered. And Joseph is able to go for a transparent part of the Severati, moving it through its light, and you hit straight into the nucleus. At which point that Severati will explode into dazzling light and it disperses.
Oh no!
Yuki's gonna give a very satisfying nod towards Joseph.
That Joseph just killed the monk?
No, just like give him a good nod to say that he's very adept at fighting.
Well, we were supposed to kill the monks. They did say, like, they don't mind reforging.
Yeah, they don't mind if you kill them, but you don't have to kill them.
Yeah, just like they're fine dying, but
yeah,
let's try not
to. In their species, they are considered old, so they are technically ageless and sexless. So they just reform as a child somewhere else. Alrighty, Joseph takes first blood.
They retain their knowledge when they're about to kill.
You're gonna change your alignment to evil now.
Oh no.
More minuses.
If it helps, Joseph was a little bit horrified that that happened. He was not expecting to get a critical hit on that person.
I wasn't expecting to do good. I thank God I could sneak attack.
He's really trying to show off in front of Yuki.
Of course.
I don't really care. No, not about that.
This Serati will move up. And it's going to attack Yuki.
How many times?
4.
Okay, Yuki is going to try and parry two of them.
Parry's your immediate action, wasn't it? You already used
it. No, parry is... riposte is to do the immediate action to attack back. Parry is just to try and negate the melee attacks.
Does parry use anything else?
Nope, it's just to negate a melee attack against the opposed opponent's attack roll. Just uses my attack of opportunities.
How many attack opportunities do you have?
I have 4 in total. I've already used 2, so these will be my last 2. No, I have 5 in total. So I'm going to do 3.
Well, you can't do the riposte, because you said the riposte wasn't the action.
Yeah, no. The riposte, until I get the greater riposte, I can only do it once per encounter, so I can't do it again this encounter.
Okay.
But I will try and parry 3 of the attacks then. So the first one will be... Yeah, first one's a -5, -10, and -15. Which I'll include in the rolls. There we go. I'm going to make another macro for just the parry stuff.
Alrighty. You parry the first 3 and the last one's just going to miss.
Fantastic.
They basically throw out their holy palms and you just like bring up your sword and they slap onto your sword as if it's a drum. And Osa just feels like you should be doing that because you're the bard. Iskandor.
Okay, time to do something cool. I will spell synergy, so 1 black mage, 1 white mage spell. And I'll be casting Icy Prism Mass and Overwhelming Presence, which I'll put in now. The DCs are higher. So both will be... Okay, so Icy Prism Mass will be +3. Overwhelming Presence is +2 DC, and they get a -2 to their saves because it's spell centric. So effectively it's +5 and +4.
They have a -2 to their saves against Overwhelming Presence.
Yes. Because it's, if you use spell synergy, if you're targeting the same creature... Oh, wait, hold on, let me read it, because I'm pretty sure that's a single target, actually. Ignore me. Yep, any target affected by both spells takes a -2 to each save. Do you want me to put the text in?
That's fine. Alright, as you become basically what you are, because you are a messenger of a divine being, the 7 Severati monks will fall to the floor and prostrate themselves.
Cool.
Guy up top crit his save, so he's not going to.
He's still staggered then.
From Overwhelming Presence?
Yep, for 1 round.
That only says if they recover from the spell.
So it says...
Oh, makes the initial save is staggered. Okay, yeah.
And then are they encased in ice?
1 second, I'm doing that spell first. an icy prison. I don't think the bomb two need to care about icy prison because they're just coup de grâce. Reflex. You say it's -2 for this as well?
-2 and +3 DC. Yeah. So basically +5.
B fumbled, so. So he is entangled, alright. Staggered, entangled.
Also covered in like 3 foot of ice.
Yeah. So as those Severati are praying towards Iskandor the Mighty, he gets a bit boost to his ego and he plans for his big bad evil guy plan even further. And the Severati monk who's been encased in ice kind of waves his arm as he calls for a surrender.
Yeah, I'll accept that. I was considering swift actioning Ultramarine, but that's fair enough.
Are you going to be able to ignore the other Severati in here?
No. No, I do. Oh, I do anyway. I'll call off and I will dispel both spells that are affecting them all.
You're dispelling them, yeah? Because you can't dismiss these.
I could dismiss Overwhelming Presence, I'm pretty sure.
It doesn't have a D there unless you just didn't put it in there.
I will check them, but crack on. 1 minute.
Alright. I take it the rest of the party are going to accept the surrender.
Oh yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yuki will like just put her sword back onto her back.
Also will kind of fly into a frenzy, but she'll start like backing up and shaking her head to get out of it.
That's fine.
You're right. Sorry, I've got praying people now.
Yuki will look towards the party and just say, wow. I mean, I was expecting to be impressed, but wow. And then we'll look towards Galtzbot.
As you're talking to the party, you just see the Severati doing the Wayne's World, we're not worthy! We're not worthy! Towards Iskandor.
Well, Galtzbot, I hope we proved that if any issues should come, we should be able to protect.
Yes, your display of both martial might and that of magic is much more than what my monks could fight back against. It is a shame for, he then makes a buzzing noise, had to disperse as he did. But they shall reform in time.
Yes, and I'm sure I can speak upon Joseph if he doesn't mind. I sincerely feel bad that one of them had to perish.
Yeah, I agree. I apologize for that. I was taking the fight seriously, but I did not intend to fully disperse them like that. That was surprising to me as well. I wasn't even sure I was going to hit them.
Not accustomed to your own might. A good and also a bad thing. But I can say, with all certainty, that you should be able to, well, look after Fazaka as you move towards the darkness that taints our realm. Wait, what are you doing? No, Yuki, don't attack me!
You then kill Goxfeld and all the other monks come after you.
As well as Joseph.
I mean, I'm glad I wasn't even attacking. I was just parrying. I was just shining off my sword, if anything.
Sorry, the Chinese arrived literally, like, as that happened. Apologies.
Where's mine?
Well, if I knew where you lived, you might get some.
Well, Rizaka, shall we make our way?
That we should. Though the trek will be long, I hope your movement between our realm is not so uncomfortable for your kind.
We will do our best. Oh god, they're still following me.
You're their god now.
I think this runs out eventually.
One round per level.
You think it is a spell you cast?
So, fast healing 5 at the moment, yeah?
Oh, yeah.
For Yuki and Osa, yes.
I was going to say, do you need healing? But as I see their wounds, like, rapidly healing...
I was going to say, I mean, how long will it take us to get to where Vazarka's taken us? Would we just fully heal?
It'd be fully healed.
I'm growing accustomed to this plane already.
Be careful, Yuki. We may find that we have to go to a plane of opposite natures. Just be careful for that.
I'm sure. Bahamut warned.
Sorry. Go ahead.
Yeah. I am aware of the dangers. Bahamut made sure I was well warned.
Joseph's just sitting there trying to comfort Osa back into her normal state of emotion and is just starting to scratch everywhere again.
Do you have cream for this irritation?
Yeah, it's called planar travel back to our home plane.
I see. And, let's not waste time. Let us hasten.
Indeed. If we were to check about people's appearances, I'd wonder how that armor protects you. But there we are. Shall we?
Yuki will then start to look over herself.
The Separati monks will eventually come to their senses and return to their areas.
I mean, in that fight, I don't even think Yuki's armor was really doing the helping. It was more her sword that was protecting her.
No, admittedly not. No. Just like, from the art, it was just like, hmm. Yeah, happy to go if Bazaga's happy to take us. If Osa's not going to try and TPK us.
I haven't gone as far as asking Osa G to draw me art yet, as I usually do.
I'm always happy for more art.
Expect it to come soon.
My DMs are always open.
I'm not open. How dare you offer me up such?
That's a lie.
With the defeat of the Severati monks, Vazarka will lead you back out of the monastery and back into the capital city of Maradorma. The city has now fully formed during your conversation and, I'd say sparring match, but Joseph just killed one of them in the monastery. It's a grandiose display of lights of varying hues of yellow and orange, though you're unsure if you'd be welcome in any of the locales. Everyone can roll sense motive.
Sorry, I'm turning off the buff from planes because this won't help, I assume. There we go. More than a 2. Come on, roll and check. There we go.
Alright, so everyone aside from Osa can tell a lot of the emotions swirling about the divine, not divine, the holy beings, is that of fear and apprehension towards the party. At your best guess, a lot of these people still believe you to be outsiders from a demonic or devilish plane, as you fellows have a more physical form, similar to that of demons and the like. It's kind of hard to tell from which way you came. Especially when material beings can go to said realms and just move there for a home. You find a similarity from their anger towards you to that of the civilians on the material plane. When you first became Heroes of Lights in the Starlight, there are many people who were worried about your allegiances, and even though you have set up those contracts to be the Heroes of Light on particular continents, there are still several people who worry that you'd use your power for villainous ends, or that would go against the continent you represent. A few people may even see through said contracts and just see it as a peace offering rather than a solid fact. As the beings look upon you, it's hard to see if they have eyes or anything since they will have all-around vision, their eyes follow you as you move away from the capital city. As you can't really make out a sun in the sky, it's hard to say which cardinal direction you'd be going, or if these beings used the cardinal directions. However, Bazaka seems to know where they are going. And from what they say, the path that they are taking is a long, winding one, at which point you will have enough time for the fast healing to fill up your bars. However, for Joseph, it is quite the annoying trail to take. At which point, does Iskandor throw Heroism Greater back onto him or not?
It only lasts for like 20 minutes or something like that, right?
How long do you reckon we'll be traveling? Because I could always extend it.
Bazaka said it would take 3 hours.
Not yet, then.
Yeah, no, like, unless it's gonna, you can make it last for hours, then don't worry about it.
Not yet.
So, it is indeed a very uncomfortable movement for Joseph, though thankfully he's not burning alive, it's just flaking of his skin and some bleeding here or there. As you make your way through the elemental plane of Holy, your vision continues to extend further and further, and to the point that your vision is almost as wide as it would have been on the material plane. Vast lands of light could be seen as far as you can, well, see. The lack of trees makes this place feel almost as if you're on a moon or some such, as well as the lack of winds carrying no scent on it. The floor, still a solid plane beneath your feet, also stretches out as far as you can see, and you're able to make out some other beings that move across the plane. Aside from holy elementals that generally just float, you see animalistic light beams move around, though nothing really seems to be hunting one another, as the things are made of light, you're unsure if they even need sustenance. You'll know that the Severati don't need to eat or drink or sleep, so it's possible it extends to the others. And since the elementals are, well, elementals, they don't need to do any of those either. You could see it as a peaceful terrain, as nothing needs to hunt, but it also doesn't feel quite right. You're unsure if you'd like to stay here forever, but it's always a option if you just ask Minerva. Have this as a vacation stay. Joseph just needs to get some sunscreen.
The natural place is warped.
You say warped, this is their normal.
Well, that's what I mean, for us it's warped.
Yeah. And as you make your way towards your destination, I need everyone to give me a will save, please.
Once again, Jasta saves her through the roof.
I've had bad experiences of my saves ruining my characters, so I always make sure they're like my top priorities.
Fair enough.
And yes, I am a fighter that has a very high will save. I worked on that.
Don't fighters get bonuses to will saves?
They yes, do. But it's not high, like, and it's their weaker save.
Plus 1 at 8, and then plus 2 at 16 or something.
Yeah, it's not high.
Yeah, so just from my fighter class, I get plus 1. I've got it from everything else.
Fair enough.
As you move through the Elemental Plane, Joseph and Osa, it's fitting that you both feel this together, you both feel a scratching in the back of your head and a crawling sensation as if spiders are working their way through your ears. As well as that, you can feel as if something is watching you.
I am paranoid.
Yuki will sort of nudge his Gendorum, like, is that scratching thing contagious? Because they're both doing it now.
What do you mean, Yuki? And he'll look back at them. Are there any physical signs of their distress?
Well, they probably are shifting about it.
Yeah, so we'll definitely just, like, shake her head and her ears keep twitching.
Are you two okay back there?
I'm gonna do it. I'm gonna press the button.
Something's watching us.
He's gotta touch the butt!
Something's watching us?
Yeah, I feel it too.
Always feels like somebody's watching me.
Pazeka.
Trying to see what's seeing us.
Can I use a hero point to see if I press this button I immediately lose the character? Because that's a lot of spells.
Vizeka, would you happen to know anything about this?
About your companions fiddling with their physical forms?
Well, they say they feel they're being watched.
I feel like something's trying to get in my head.
It's a scratching sensation. I felt something similar on the material plane once, but it's strange that it would be here.
Well, this threat seems to, like, we are here to see what's coming into our plane. We are traversing planes, so is it really that weird that whatever is doing this is also able to do it?
Iskandor, with true seeing, you can see a fair few more native beings to this plane moving about, but that's mostly because they have innate invisibility. Nothing seems outwardly aggressive to you, and you don't see anything out of the ordinary on either Osa or Joseph.
I can't see any... can I mesh that with detect magic as well, just in case there's any kind of lingering taint on them?
Yeah, sure. You want to use detect magic?
Yeah. I just want to see if there's anything messing with
on a holy plane? Full of magic? Of holy?
Well, I can still detect... I can
detect with magical gear.
I'm glad you've got the mechanical eyes. At least you won't blind yourself.
He's not going to detect the plane itself, because if he did, he'd detect the material plane.
Okay.
Just because this place is full of holy doesn't mean it's magic, it's just this is what the plane is. It's like looking at the floor. The floor is indeed made of floor.
I take it with those combined, it doesn't give anything extra.
No, it does. You can see a thin black line going from the back of their heads and around into their ear, as if something left a trail.
Can I follow the trail?
It just, like, appears just behind their head and then goes into the ear. Do you have Mini so you can go inside their ear?
Yes.
Sadly, Mini is 10%, so even that won't work.
Alright, I'll sort of... Iskandor's hands will come up, so he's got the black mage hand checking behind Osa's ear and the white mage hand checking behind Joseph's ear. there's some kind of thread coming from you. Do you feel
thread?
Yes, like a trail, or the best way I can put it is almost like a spore from something that's been here, like a beast which has passed through. And do you feel different?
I feel... So this plane in general just kind of irritates me, but specifically there's something like in the back of my head that is super itchy, like I want to dig until it's bleeding, and then it feels like there's something crawling out of my ear that's painful and just aggravating.
I'm good. Yeah. Sorry, go on, Jack.
Yeah, just what he said, basically. Just something's in my through my ear and my head just scratching.
Do you still feel it?
GM, is it still going on?
It's there in passing, like when you scratch something, you can feel like it's like... It's not exactly burning, but it's like slowly fading away.
Kind of. It's not as much as it was, but it's... Like, it's slowly going away, but it's still kind of there.
Is Gondora looking into their ear?
Yeah, absolutely. I'm doing right, full doctor checks.
Roll me religion.
Let me find it. There we go. Ah, it's not like it.
Okay, I'll let you know that was exactly what you needed. Alright.
Nice.
As you look into Osa's and Joseph's ear, looking at the magical trail and peering into their ear as much as you can see a much more recent form of the magical trail, and you can identify that these two have gained knowledge. You don't know what the knowledge is about, though.
You've been tampered with. You've been given some kind of knowledge, but I don't know what or why. Just be careful of any sudden epiphanies you may have. I don't think they're yours.
Can I just have a real hard think and see if I know anything that I don't think I knew?
I don't think Sadly, so. No.
And at which point, Iskandor, you remember that those bloody messes of brain mass also were imprinted with knowledge.
Do I still have that brain?
Well, you don't have the singular brain, but you can always pick them out if you want.
No, I'm just thinking I need to look into them later on. Like, I need to probably, when I get rest time, I might have to not experiment on them. Yeah, pick the brains. Not Joseph and Osa's, just to clarify.
At least not literally, I hope.
Yeah.
I hope.
You're not going to pick up raids, right? Right?
Oh, yeah, because I've got those brains that I took away from that site, didn't I? So I'll have to look at them at some point in the near future.
Yes.
I will not worry them. Not tell them that, and say, I don't think you're in any immediate danger, but I will be looking into this.
Thanks for looking out for us, Iskandor.
It's fine. I'd rather I'm the one seeing this than you three. But there shouldn't be any ill effects I can discern. It seems like it's just knowledge you've been imprinted with. As I say, if you just be mindful, you may have some sudden flashes of memories that may not necessarily be your own. Just do be careful.
Yeah, well, the Heroes of Light, it would make sense to make us some kind of targets for whatever. Just one more thing to be mindful of.
let's press on then. Apologies, the two of you. We can move now. I take it looking at Yuki, she's not got this problem.
Nope, she's fine.
Alright.
If anything, she looks too fine. It's a bit suspicious.
What's your touch?
20.
Okay. Yeah, we can move on.
You remember that samurai that cut through magic? I can't do that.
I was going to say, I also have taken precautions for that.
Nah. Yeah, I can't do that. So don't shoot me with magic.
You say that, you can learn that feature with martial
capability. I could, yeah.
It should be that thing that would like stop you. I can't do that, so please don't kill me.
But now you've given me the knowledge that I can do that, so.
It's like a really weird game of rock, paper, scissors. Right.
Yep, with the investigation into your allies' brains, you continue moving on. Though the thoughts of someone watching you isn't going to be the best state of affairs, but you'll have to put it in the back of your head, so to speak. Did you take some mental damage from that?
Just a little bit. 1d4 psychic damage.
Yeah. And as you follow Vizarka to the spot of where the darkness has been hiding within, you find a large wall that says loading 1 week timer, as we will end the session here.
Joseph, Osa, get on the operating table and check your heads.
Mm-hmm. I do not consent.
I trust you. And I disappear.
Roll me 6 will saves.